If you want to talk about Division III basketball,
I got a feeling
you've logged on to the right place.
Welcome to the big show.
Whereas on the men's side, I think they overloaded two of the brackets. And as a result, I think we're not going to get a good Final Four in the sense of who everyone really would like to see there.
The system is a mess, guys, but I think that's neither here nor there.
The next 3 hours, we'll cover it all.
We don't have the time to move pieces because conferences are playing their title games on Sunday afternoon at 4 o'clock, for God's sake. I'll tell you what, I'll support them. You guys are going to get to the Sweet 16 and get annihilated by Stevens Point.
With regional reports.
We've talked a lot about the fact on the men's side that there's not a lot of dominant teams, and the flip side of that is that you have a lot of parity that makes the conference races exciting.
And interviews with coaches.
Hey, it's great to be on Hoopsville. I tell you, it's that time of the year.
Yeah, it is.
Thanks for having me. Thank you very much for having me.
This D3 basketball is the greatest. The players, they play because they love it. They're fun. The teams are playing. You go to these other campuses, it's where it's at.
And we knew that the ODAC competition was going to be very tough. We knew that each coach had done their job with recruiting. And there were so many young teams that we just knew that each and every night when we played an ODAC contest that we had our work cut out for us.
We'll talk about who's on top.
And the CCRW is much like the Wisconsin League, the WIAC, in that, really, it's a cliche, but it's true. On any night, anyone can beat you.
Those surprises.
Every game counts, especially
play
the
your season.
Games.
Yeah. Don't lose to a bad team.
Well, and don't lose your conference tournament.
And who's making news in Division III?
We got an awful tough league, and we have some tough games this week, but we're still tied for first place in our league in the lost column.
And as you point out, they're not a reliable team in the NCAA tournament. They've proven it year in and year out that you can't count.
You can even join in and chat with us.
I mean, this lower right-hand bracket is loaded.
This bracket is ridiculous. I mean, you could take a final. This could be a Final Four bracket. You want to play that Thursday game because you have not won an NCAA tournament game. You got to go out there and show yourselves that you can actually do it.
So sit back and relax, and let's talk D3 hoops.
We talked before about Hope Calvin being far and away the number one rivalry in Division III basketball. You can't dispute it.
I think the WIAC always deserves two teams in the poll for sure, and probably three.
Well, one, I think they got the easiest run to a possible Final Four. They don't have a lot of challenges on the way.
There were three teams in that region that deserved first-round buys.
Exactly.
And only two could get them.
Now it's time for Hoopsville.
Great show. Keep this up. This is a good thing for D3, and I will enjoy listening to the rest of the show.
Let's get it started in here.
Everybody, everybody, let's get into it. Get stomping. Get it started. Get it started. Get it started. Let's get it started.
Here's your host, Dave McHugh.
And welcome into Hoopsville, everybody. I hope you are enjoying the NCAA tournaments, which have kicked off already. I am your host, Dave McHugh, Chris Tarr, producer extraordinaire in the background. As the men's tournament has started, we will get updates shortly. Women's tournament will kick off tomorrow. I am your host, Dave McHugh. I'm got lots of ways you can communicate with us. Let's see. There's Twitter. There's AOLIM. There's email, there's Facebook, you name it. We've got it covered for you. Let's start with the basics. On Twitter, it's at D3Hoopsville. That's at D3Hoopsville or hashtag Hoopsville. You can also join us on Facebook at facebook.com/Hoopsville. You can also join us on AOLIM. That's Hoopsville 2000, Hoopsville 2000. You can join us in the chat room if you happen to be listening to us on Ustream on their actual channel. There is a chat room alongside. And email address is hoopsville at d3hoops.com. That's hoopsville at d3hoops.com. We have a ton lined up tonight. We're going to be covering the men's and women's basketball tournament in its entirety tonight. Well, not really. We're going to have a team from each section on the men's and women's side, and at the end, we hopefully will have time to talk to Pat Coleman quickly and get his take on who will persevere in the first weekend on the women's side. But quickly, we mentioned that the men's teams have tipped off. And as a result, one game's underway. And our D3Hoops.com's Frank Rossi joins us from New NYU, where they're taking on Misericordia, Frank.
Dan, can you hear me?
I can hear you, but barely.
Yes, it's an electric atmosphere in Manhattan. And right now, the score is 44-39, NYU leading Misericordia. Misericordia had a one-point lead at halftime, Dan. Neither team has led by more than six. And that was NYU halfway through the first half. This game has been really dominated, though, by Ethan Eichhorst of Misericordia for 17 points for the first half. He averages 17.8 a game. On the other side, NYU, Ben Gorman at 10 points for the first half. The halftime schedule was 37-36, but NYU has gone on a run here in the second half, and they have taken the 44-39 lead with 16:56 left in the second half.
Frank, what's been the story of the game? Obviously, big crowd. Obviously, Misericordia hanging tough. Is NYU struggling, or is Misericordia actually playing good basketball here?
Misericordia is actually hitting their free throw. That's what the difference was, because NYU has shot 52% in the first half versus 46% for Misericordia. And Misericordia made 7 of 7 free throws versus 3 for 6 for NYU. Both had 4 turnovers in the first half. It's been a somewhat sloppy game at times, but both teams are just... They had a little bit of jitters coming out, and then they went on a pretty good run from the 16 to 12 minute mark. Today's a reminder also, media timeouts have really caused a lot of swaying in this game. A lot of teams are not used to them, and it looks like in this tournament, we're going to be seeing them all the way through.
And quickly, Frank, obviously the fans are getting into this. This game matches up against Amherst. We'll get an update from you later on. But what's the fan atmosphere been like?
You know what? People always joke around about NYU's basketball program not getting support. Well, this is my first time in this gym, and let me tell you, I am very surprised based on those assessments, because it was a pretty packed house here tonight. There was a line out the door waiting to get in, and students showing their IDs. So there is a lot of support behind this NYU team and some Misericordia fans that make the trip as well.
Very good. Frank Rossi joining us from NYU, where Misericordia has taken on NYU in the very first round of the NCAA tournament. Frank, thank you for joining us. Keep us in touch. We'll get back to you later in the game, maybe when it's over.
You got it.
All right, Frank Rossi joining us on the Hoopsville Hotline. Appreciate him taking the time to do that. Again, Misericordia and NYU battling in the first round of the NCAA tournament. We'll try and keep you abreast of what is going on throughout that, and Frank will join us once or two more times. Also, just an update on who we've got tonight. Salem State will be joining us momentarily on the hotline. They'll be taking on Rhode Island College in the first round. Chris Harvey will join us. Rose-Hulman, surprising winner in the HCAC. A lot of interesting points about them. Jim Shaw will join us from Rose-Hulman about their game coming up. Hartwick women basketball playing very good basketball this season. Missy West will join us. Fourth season there. Certainly turned the Hartwick program around. She has a knack of doing that. We'll talk about her team and their success. Have we forgotten about the defending national champions? We have not. The men's side, St. Thomas, they get in by winning their conference tournament against Gustavus Adolphus. We'll talk to their technically first-year coach Johnny Tarr about the defending champs and whether they can make a run this year. Castleton State, they are our school of the week, and they are into the NCAA tournament. We will talk to them. Chris will get his five questions ready for Quick Fire 5 tonight. Misericordia women in. You might have heard me joke on Monday night about the fact that for the first time, at least in my memory, and I would dare say the history of NCAA Division III basketball, the former committee chair for the men's committee last year is now the women's basketball coach on an interim basis at Misericordia. It's our good friend Dave Martin. He will join us to talk about his team, and now he's coached both teams at that program. At that school. We'll talk to him about that. Carthage women's basketball playing very good basketball as well. We'll talk to Tim Bernero about that. And then almost a legend in Division III basketball. There are a few in women's basketball. Nancy Faye comes to mind. Mike Strong up at Scranton certainly comes to mind. Gary Fifield. He'll be joining us from Southern Maine, winner of over 600 games in his career, certainly back in the NCAA tournament. You remember Southern Maine back in the late 90s, early 2000s, a dominating team. We'll talk to him about how his Huskies are doing so far this year. And obviously dancing coming out of the Little East. Again, if you have questions, email us at hoopsville@d3hoops.com. That's hoopsville@d3hoops.com. Get IM us at hoopsville2000 on your AOL IM. Join us on Facebook at facebook.com/hoopsville. Though honestly, you can ask questions there. We'll try and get to them. There's a lot of websites up on my screen. That one tends to not get there, but that is where we will post our archives. Hoopsville2000, AOL IM, I believe I mentioned. Email address, chat room if you are listening via the Ustream actual page. If you're on d3hoopsville.com and you're watching there, there is no chat room, but there are other ways, as we mentioned, especially Twitter, to ask questions, and we will do our best to answer those questions along the way. And let's not waste any time, as we, as you can tell, have a very full schedule tonight. We are going to jump into the Northeast region and go up to Salem State, where Coach Chris Harvey joins us on the show. Coach, welcome to Hoopsville.
Thanks for having me, guys.
I certainly appreciate you taking the time to join us. Vikings, a pretty solid season, 20-7 overall, 10-2 in the conference. You go and win the conference title, beating Bridgewater State 83-71. You'll take on Rhode Island College in the first round at Staten Island. And, Coach, in your fifth year, you got to be pretty pleased with how this team has performed. This is your third dance with this team.
Yeah, we've been very fortunate this year. Number one, we've stayed healthy, and we've had tremendous play by our preseason All-American, Brian Clark, who's a two-time player of the year in the conference. We're getting steady play out of our point guard, Apollo Wade, second-team All-Conference player from a year ago. And just good contributions from all around. We're very balanced. The kids have worked hard, and like I said, we've stayed healthy all year. We've won 10 in a row here as we look to Rhode Island College tomorrow night.
Yeah, 10 in a row, certainly a great run to be on against a Rhode Island College that is certainly playing very good basketball from what you have seen on tape so far. And as you prepare for tomorrow night's game, what do you think you need to do to get past the anchorman, or what are the anchormen going to have to do to get past you?
Well, that's a great way to look at it. We've always been focused on what we do, whether you call it the John Wooden philosophy of, focus on what we're doing and make teams adjust. But, Coach Walsh, good friend of mine, Rhode Island College, I think they've gone to the Sweet 16 2 years in a row. So it's a major challenge for our kids. But, if you guys look at us on paper and you match us up, this is a very good matchup. I would say, though, I think defensively they're a little bit better, more consistent defensively than we are. But, the matchup is right there. They've got three guys in double figures. We got three guys in double figures. So this is just really going to be a great, great basketball game. It's a tough first-round matchup for both teams, but I think we'll be ready.
Talking to men's basketball coach Chris Harvey from Salem State, joining us here on the Hoopsville Hotline. Coach, you mentioned a couple of your players. Let's talk to them about them in a little bit more detail. Brian Clark, one of your captains, 19.4 points a game, over 6 rebounds, and he's shooting 63% from the floor. Does this guy miss?
I tell you what, guys, he's not a three-point shooter.
Right.
In our second-to-last conference game at Worcester State, a tough place to play, a small gym. It's like 88 feet long, it seems like. There's no room to breathe. He hits a 30-foot three-point shot that the second left his hands, you were like, it's in. The thing about Brian is he's just been consistent for 4 years. He's been a 4-year starter for us from the day he walked in. Him and his twin brother Dan won a state championship in high school their senior year. It's only fitting that they're going out as conference champions, and they want to make a run here. Brian's very effective around the basket, knows how to use his body very well, can score. My only thing with Brian is he's so quiet that he never argues for a call, that he never gets the benefit of the doubt when he's around the basket. It's crazy. I just think the officials think he's going to score, so he never gets the and-one call. He never argues a call. He's got the same expression whether, the game's on the line or it's the jump ball. So he's, been terrific for us and going to be very hard to replace.
Certainly he's going to be hard to replace. Another guy who's coming along, though, very nicely behind him, Junior Nate Simpson, 13.2 points a game, 9.3 rebounds. He's got 32 blocks, 33 steals, shoots 49% and 35% from beyond the arc. And you also have Andrew White, a sophomore, nearly 11 points, 3 rebounds, 50 steals, and shooting 48%. While you will lose certainly contributions in Brian Clark and Apollos Wade, you certainly have guys behind them that are playing well, especially early in their careers.
Well, yes, right. Nate Simpson is as tough as they come. He's 6'4", he's undersized, he's got terrific bounce in his legs, plays above the rim, crafty around the basket. You know, Sharp's developing. You know, he's a kid who can make threes. Sometimes it's fool's gold. You know, he can run off four in a row and, you know, look real hot with it, and then he'll go cold. But he puts in the hours to make his game better. So, you know, like you say, he's a young kid who's continuing to find himself within the ranks of college basketball. Andrew White, sophomore, arguably, I think, the best defender in our conference in terms of the guard position. A wiry kid, kind of reminds you, you know, it's probably a bad analogy, but a Rajon Rondo type. If you look at his jump shot, it doesn't look pretty, but he makes shots. He can get to the basket. He's the only guy we allow to play with his hands on defense. I mean, he's so quick laterally that, you know, he can make a little gamble and still keep the opponent in front of him.
I'm talking to Coach Chris Harvey here in his fifth season at Salem State. Coach, you're a graduate of Worcester State. I won't name the year, don't worry. We mentioned already you're making your third NCAA tournament trip with this team. This is the 20th, though, for this program after our 20th. 23rd, I said 22nd. I can't even read my own notes. 22nd NCAA tournament. Yeah, 16 conference titles, 20 regular season titles. Clearly, Salem State is about winning. What is different, though, maybe with your tenure there?
Well, you know, nothing's changed, to be honest with you. You know, when this job opened up 5 years ago, you know, there were applicants who had played in the NBA, to some minor coaching in the NBA, to, you know, Division I assistants all the way down to high school coaches. So, you know, to be blessed enough to earn this job is it's everything I could have asked for. You know, there's an expectation to win, and, you know, we do subscribe to the Division III philosophy. I mean, we're here to graduate our players, which we're doing. You know, but at the end of the day, as athletes and coaches, we want to win basketball games, and, you know, there's high expectations here, which is what we want. You know, we expect to compete for championships. You know, I was hired with the intent that, you know, we would keep that tradition going, and quite honestly, the only thing missing from the trophy case at Salem State University is a national championship.
Yeah.
We've been to the Final Four, you know, the Elite Eight, second round, first round, and so on. Most recently a Sweet 16 in my second year. So, you know, there's high expectations, but that's what we want. You know, there's a sideline to this story, too. I'm stuck on 199 wins right now.
Yes.
As a coach. So, you know, tomorrow has a lot of ramifications. You know, I truly believe, though, you know, I've always said this when people ask, what's your record? I'm 0-0. You know, the kids that I've been able to coach and the staff that I've been a part of has put me in a pretty good position to have some success.
And quickly, the response on campus.
Well, you know, we've got a vibrant community here at Salem State University. You know, everybody comes out and supports each other. It's a neat basketball town if you've never been. I mean, there's, you know, just like any town, any small town across the country, you know, you've got the folks that grew up in the area that just love basketball, and they come out. So, you know, we've got a great blend of that college vibe, but also the community vibe comes out and sees us. So, you know, everybody, you go down to the local, you know, bagel store, somebody's asking you how the game went the night before. And, you know, want to know why you didn't hedge that ball screen properly in the second half. You know, but, you know, like I said, man, if you want to be around basketball, Salem's just a phenomenal place.
And we mentioned you graduated from Worcester State. Obviously, you play them in conference play. What is it like to play against your alma mater? Or I should say coach against your alma mater.
Well, you know, my heart is always, you know, a Lancer at Worcester State, but, you know, they actually, my coach, I played baseball in college. The coach at Worcester State, the time that I was cut as a freshman, is Tommy Moore, who's now the head coach at Quinnipiac. I'm replacing, and he calls me all the time to remind me that it was a bad mistake. But, you know, I think life worked out for everybody. You know, and my good friend, I replaced Sean Doherty. He's the associate head coach down at Quinnipiac. So it's a small, small world, you know, but it's always nice to go back home to Worcester and see everybody there and be a part of that campus as well.
Wrapping up here with Chris Harvey, Salem State. Again, taking on Rhode Island College. The games will be at Staten Island, and obviously you're down in that area as it is. As always, we give the coach the final word here on Hoopsville. Any final thoughts you want to share with those who are listening tonight?
I just want to thank you guys for everything you do for Division III basketball. It's the purest form of basketball out there, and you know, all of us owe you guys a debt of gratitude for everything you guys do. You know, I appreciate it. I just want to say, if you don't mind, my two kids are at home in the Boston area,
sure,
probably lying down listening to Dad. I just want to say that I love them, and Daddy's going to come home with two wins on Sunday morning.
There you go. I like the way you think. Rhode Island College ahead of you. And let's just look, since you said there's two wins coming, that means you'll take on probably an MIT or a Hartwick or Farmingdale State. Heck, you might even get a surprising Skidmore there. So nice road ahead of you.
Absolutely. We appreciate it, guys.
Thank you for taking the time to join us. Good luck tomorrow night.
I appreciate everything again. Thanks. Take care.
Thank you. Take care. Chris Harvey joining us from Salem State. Appreciate him taking the time to do that. And nice shout out to the family back in the Boston area. So Salem State, our first of seven guests down. We'll get back to more here in just a bit. We're going to take a break. And when we come back, Rose-Hulman will join us from the Midwest region, talk about their surprising entry into the NCAA tournament, though certainly well-deserved. And then we'll jump up into New York State, talk to Hartwick women's basketball coach Missy West. That's coming up after the break. Quickly, score updates for you. NYU and Mizra Cordy, as we mentioned, playing 8-0 run, has allowed NYU to go up 56-46 with 10:36 remaining in the second half. That's 56-46 with 10:36 remaining in the second half. We'll get an update from Frank Rossi later in the show. You're listening to Hoopsville, presented by D3Hoops.com. We'll be back right after this.
Are you an embarrassment on the dance floor? Do you confuse state capitals and read too many celebrity gossip magazines? Well, if you answered yes, you may have what it takes to adopt a teen from foster care. Because teens don't need perfection, they need you. So if you think an MP3 is a computer virus, it's okay. There are thousands of teens in foster care who would love to put up with you. For more information, call 1-888-200-4005 or go to AdoptUsKids.org. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, Adopt Us Kids, and the Ad Council.
Who are you?
What are your team colors?
Who can make you cheer?
Who can bring your family and friends together?
And play your fight song?
Who can bring you to your feet?
Or bring you to your knees?
When the game is on the line, who do you want to take the last shot?
And who do you want to slap high fives, jump up and down, and yell at the top of your lungs with?
There's probably a game near you today.
NCAA basketball. Who's your team?
All season long, let D3Football.com be your home for all the Division III football action on the road to the Stag Bowl. From interactive blogs and message boards to columns from around the region and around the nation on your favorite teams, nobody covers NCAA Division III better than D3Football.com. As the playoffs approach, get the scoop on who's in and who's out from the experts who picked all 32 teams last year. Don't go anywhere else. Get the info from the source for Division III football at www.d3football.com.
We've got more schools than Division I, more fans than Division II, and more upsets than March Madness. There's 800 programs with over 11,000 games leading to two national championships. And we've been covering it all for over a decade. From Eastern to Occidental, from Puget Sound to Piedmont, from Southwestern to the University of New England, and from Hope to Calvin. Nobody covers Division III basketball like we do. We're at D3Hoops.com at www.d3hoops.com.
And welcome back to Hoopsville. I'm your host, Dave McHugh. Chris Taher working the phones behind us. Got lots ahead of us and certainly plenty to talk about as the men's basketball tournament has officially tipped off with two games. Bethany at St. Mary's of Maryland and Mizra Cordy at NYU. Frank Rossi for D3 Hoops is at the NYU game. We'll give you updates there. We'll also try and get you updated scores on the Mary Washington game if you're listening here. Plenty of ways to contact us. Again, email us at hoopsville@d3hoops.com. That's hoopsville@d3hoops.com. You can IM us at hoopsville2000 on your AOL IM. Oh, come on, think, Dave. What have I forgotten? Oh, yeah, Twitter. Darn, the easiest one possible. Twitter, @D3Hoopsville or #Hoopsville, or join us in the chat room. I know there's some people listening in there. Certainly feel free to share your questions or comments or whatever, and we'll try and even ask those to the guests who are on the air. Speaking of guests who are on the air, joining us now on the Hoopsville Hotline as we keep this show moving tonight, Jim Shaw from Rose-Hulman joins us. Coach, welcome to Hoopsville.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here. I'm happy we're in a position where you even want me on the show.
Well, I'll have to admit, you were my first thought when I saw you guys take out Transylvania back on Saturday to win the automatic qualifier. First and foremost, I usually see you in Salem almost every year. It's got to be nice to be back in the NCAA tournament yourself.
Oh, it's very nice. Obviously, some of us coaches get together in Roanoke, Salem, for the Final Four every year, but this is really special for us and our kids. It's been a few years since we've been in, and none of the kids in the program now have ever been in, so it's a really fun time. Which, by the way, if there's some background noise, I'm at the Scott Trade Center in St. Louis watching the Missouri Valley Tournament. Wow. Indiana State, our local Division I school, is playing tonight, so I ducked into a corner out in the lobby, so you might hear a horn now and then or something like that.
Well, not only are you getting ready for North Central, who you will play at WashU, but you're taking in a D1 game as well. You've got it multitasking here.
Yeah, and what you're more likely to hear is a beer vendor, but so just want to caution you about that.
No
problem. If you hear somebody yelling cold beer, it's just a guy walking by.
Just go get one for me. 19th season, Coach. You guys finished the season 20-8 overall, 11-7 in the conference, finishing third. That 20 win, the win over Transylvania, is just the fourth time in program history that you guys have hit 20 wins. Fifth NCAA appearance under you, 9 in school history, but the first time, as you mentioned, since the 98-99 season. This season has certainly been a pretty solid one for the Engineers.
Yeah, we had really high expectations coming in. We had pretty much everybody back, and we played really well in November and December, with maybe one or two exceptions, and then we started the conference out pretty well, and we had a real lull, which a lot of people do in late January, early February. We just showed a lot of wear and tear. We were just worn out. I tell people, you can get over being tired with a good night's sleep and maybe a day off, but it takes about as long to get when you're worn out, it takes about as long to get back as it took to get you worn out. And we eventually came off the road. We were at 6 out of 7 on the road, really in the middle of a really difficult academic grind. And once we got kind of over that hump, we started playing well. And it started with a home loss to Transy. Sometimes when you play and lose, you can still play well. And against a good team like Transy, we did. And after that, we played pretty well with maybe one exception when we lost to a good Defiance team. We weren't terrible, but we weren't good enough to beat them at home. And other than that, we played really well.
Talking to Rose-Hulman's men's basketball coach, Jim Shaw, as we mentioned in his 19th season, the win over Transylvania, just the second in conference title in school history. You're led by Julian Strickland and Austin Weatherford. Strickland was the HCAC tourney MVP, scored a career-high 30 against Transylvania. Of course, Weatherford was also an HCAC tourney member. The team, those two are certainly just part of the equation. You guys are also getting other contributions, but, you know, you got Strickland's 12.9, you got Weatherford's 12.7 points a game, John Gerken 7.2, you got a number of other guys there contributing. The rebounds are rather equal, the assists are rather equal, though Weatherford's the leader at 72. You shoot well from the floor, you keep your opponents shooting low. What's been the secret? I'll get to one of the other little statistical surprises on the defensive side, but on the offensive side, what's been the secret so far this season?
Well, we've been pretty balanced, and we've been fairly deep, and by that we've had our two leading scorers just right around 12.5 points a game, and we've gotten contributions from a lot of different people at a lot of different times. as a coach, sometimes it's hard to figure out who's going to be there on a given night, and sometimes I have to play around with it. Sometimes, you know, I don't know, and that happens. But during the course of the year, we've gotten really, really solid contributions from a lot of people. And this past weekend, we also got good insight play offensively from John Gerken and Brent Ballsbaugh, and we were pretty solid defensively. And then I would say this past weekend, our toughness really showed. We played 125 minutes and 44 hours, and that's a highly competitive basketball. Three very tough opponents. Our first-round opponent, Defiance, we lost to 2 weeks before, and they gave us everything we wanted. Not a lot of time to rest, guys. Julian played more minutes than he ever did during the regular season. And I think our depth helped us be able to do that in a three-day stretch because we weren't maybe as worn down at the end of the season as we could have been otherwise. But the real statistical thing for us in the tournament is we played 125 minutes and committed less than 20 turnovers. And that's hard to do. And when you get shots, in two of the three games we shot at a high percentage, shot it well from the perimeter, you're going to be pretty good offensively when you get shots up there. And we've been pretty good at taking care of it during the year, but that's pretty extraordinary.
What is also extraordinary, besides the very low number of turnovers, especially against very good teams, especially in Transylvania, you finished the season number two in the NCAA in scoring defense, only allowing 56 points a game. That certainly didn't happen against Transylvania. But, you know, that's a staggering number when anybody can keep, on an average, teams below 60.
Well, and we did a really great job early in the year and in our non-conference year. And, you know, this time of year, people know each other so well. And I knew Trancy's a really hard cover. And they had a kid go for 21 in the first half that isn't one of their two big scorers. He's just their shooter. And he went nuts on us. And when you get to that, it's hard to keep people at low numbers. Some of it's tempo. We don't slow it down, but we're not racing up the floor, and we run a lot of motion, which takes some time off the clock when we have the ball. So some of it's a little bit of an aberration. You know, some of it's tempo-related. But we'll take it. We've been pretty solid defensively. Defensively, we basically just don't give up a lot of easy shots. We make you earn your baskets, try not to put you on the foul line too much, and make you take contested jump shots and hopefully get the defensive rebound. It's pretty simple philosophy.
Certainly. Jim Shaw joining us here. From Rose-Hulman, you obviously are at Wash U. You'll take on North Central tomorrow in the first round. What have you seen on tape from the CCIW champs? What are you preparing for? What do you think you can do against them?
What I've seen on tape is nothing I particularly like. I wish they weren't what I thought they were. They're very good. I mean, obviously, you win the CCIW regular season and the conference tournament, and you're a very good basketball team. What impresses me the most is they have a lot of balance. They have a lot of kids who can play, but they're very well coached. Their kids really know what they're doing. They have a real purpose with everything. If you make a mistake defensively or out in a passing lane, they will find the right read. Their kids are great at reading cuts. You know, they run a particular system, and you can tell that they've been guarded every way conceivable doing that, and they know exactly what to do to counter what a defense does. You know, they've got great balance inside and outside. They got really good post players that can score. The kid's just a real beast in there, and they have some length, which we're fairly long, and that's something that served us well this year. But they're extremely long on the wing and very skilled, can shoot it. They've got a great point guard. They've got great balance between the inside and the outside, too. So it's obviously a really tough challenge. You know, I thought we met a great, really tough challenge against an outstanding Transylvania team Sunday. You know, but this is a different kind of challenge. They're different than Transylvania. And it's also an opponent that we're not as familiar with. When we played Transy, we'd already played them twice.
Right.
You know, we had a little bit more of an idea. So we'll see what happens tomorrow. But it's definitely a really tough game.
What do you think you're going to bring to the table that North Central won't be ready to handle?
Oh, I'm sure they'll be ready to handle any of it. as we talked about earlier, I think we're pretty solid defensively. And our motions, when we're shooting the ball well – our motion is hard to guard. And, you know, if we're not shooting it well, it's not so hard to guard. And I guess any coach's offense is pretty much like that. But when we can make shots and pull people, you know, out of the lane and spread the floor properly, then we're pretty good offensively. When we don't make shots, we lose a little confidence, and people can pack it in on us, it makes it a little tougher on us. I think we're pretty good on the wings and in the backcourt. We don't score a lot in the post, but I think we got a couple guys who are capable, and we're going to need them to do so.
Jim Shaw joining us here from Rose-Hulman as they make their first NCAA tournament appearance since 98-99, the ninth overall, his fifth as well, as they defeated Transylvania back on Saturday to win the ACAC automatic qualifier. Coach, obviously, I'm going to look forward to seeing you in Salem nonetheless, and I know your team is looking forward to maybe making a little bit of a run here. But we'll let you get back to the game you're at and get ready for tomorrow as well. So, as always, we give the coach the final word on Hoopsville. Any final thoughts you'd like to share?
Well, we're just really excited. We're excited about playing in the NCAA tournament. We're excited about winning the conference tournament. The HCAC is a great league. We beat a really, really outstanding team in Transylvania. It was really well coached. Class acts down in Transy. It was a great tournament. And what I tell people is, people watch the Division I basketball tournament, and they think that the goal is to play in the tournament. And at our level, with so few at-large bursts, I think the goal is to win a conference championship. The reward is get to do this and play in the NCAA tournament. Our guys are very excited, but, you know, practices have been very focused, believe in themselves, and it's a great time. And we're going to go out and not lose track of having some fun, too. Hey, and then the other thing I'd like to say is just thank you guys for everything you do for small college basketball. These kids give a tremendous sacrifice and jump through a lot of hoops, so to speak, to play Division III basketball. And it's nice that guys like you give them their just due, and I appreciate it.
Hey, we appreciate you taking the time to join us. I forgot to ask you, I'm actually heading to Lexington, Kentucky this weekend to cover the Transylvania pod. Any suggestions or tips I should have as I arrive in Lexington?
Hey, one of my favorite sights is seeing Lexington in the rearview mirror, so just remember that. just say hi to my friends down at Transy, and I'm really pulling for them. You'll really enjoy watching them play, and you'll really enjoy your time there at Transy. It's a first-class facility, first-class people. They'll treat you right, and it should be some great basketball at that site, as well as obviously where we're at here over here to watch you.
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much, and I'll keep that rearview mirror in mind when I when I'm at Transylvania in your honor, and I'll try not to let them know you thought that.
Okay.
Hey, Coach, thanks so
much.
Take care of yourself. Jim Shaw joining us from Rose-Hulman. Appreciate him taking the time to do that. We're quickly going to get our next guest up on the line, and we're going to switch to women's basketball. And Hartwick's women's basketball coach, Missy West, will join us here shortly. I actually got a little distracted before the show catching up on her resume. Heck of a resume. But in the meantime, let's get you updated on some scores. For starters, a little surprise to me, nothing against the Seahawks, who in the last, two years at least, I've covered in the first rounds of the NCAA tournament. They are blowing the doors off of Bethany right now, 57-40 with 7:42 remaining in the second half. That is 57-40, Seahawks up on Bethany. And another surprise, NYU was, NYU and Misericordia were in a battle. Misericordia led by one at the half and looked like a dogfight, but it has broken open. NYU went on at least a 10-0 run and now lead 72-56 with 3:27 remaining. Misericordia needs to get it in action there, and so does Bethany if they want any chance to get back in. But both games almost turning into routs. We'll hear from Frank Rossi shortly with an update from his game at NYU and Misericordia coming up here shortly. Again, if you have any questions for us, email us at hoopsville@d3hoops.com. That's hoopsville@d3hoops.com. You can IM us at hoopsville2000 on your AOL IM, or join us on Twitter, where I am about to send out who our next guest is on the show. And you can also join us on Facebook at facebook.com. But the Twitter address is @d3hoopsville and #hoopsville. Now, there's also a chat room if you happen to be watching the show via our Ustream link. or on the Ustream page. There is a chat room there, and if you have questions or comments, please feel free to share them there. And I'm trying to get this up so I don't lose track of what we're doing. This is how you do things all at the same time. See, we type away and we do everything as I try and do everything. And we'll just leave it at that. And joining us now on the Hoopsville Hotline, as we switch to the women's side of the basketball bracket, obviously the women have not started, but Missy West from Hartwick Women's Basketball joins us here on the Hoopsville Hotline. Coach, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having us.
Well, I appreciate it. 22-5 this year, 12-2 in the Empire 8. You did, unfortunately, lose to Ithaca, which seemed to run rampant on both sides of the Empire 8 tournament, losing to Ithaca 43-38 in a very surprisingly low-scoring game to make the NCAA tournament. Quickly, your reactions on that and the fact that you guys tripped up twice out of the last three times you went out there.
Yeah, I think this time it was a defensive battle, and I think it easily could have gone either way. And, I mean, there were seven ties in the game, and it came right down to the last 2 minutes of the game. And when the buzzer went off, they hit two or three more shots more than we did, and that's what it really came down to. If we had some extended time, maybe the results would have been different. But, you know, between us, it's going to be a battle. It's always going to be a battle. And, you know, I thought we played really good defense, and we played with a lot of heart and a lot of passion. And unfortunately, we missed a couple shots and they hit them. And that was kind of, you know, the reason why they won and we didn't. But I'm still really proud of our girls. And I, you know, looking back at that game, I still am pretty excited about what we did and the amount of effort that they put into that game.
You'll be taking on Emmanuel in the next round. The game's being played at Rhode Island College. Tell us a little bit of what you've seen on tape about Emmanuel that you're prepping for, and what do you think you can take advantage of from the Hawks' point of view?
You know, I really, really respect them. I think they're a very good team. I think they're a really well-coached team, and they have a very up-tempo game style. And we need to be able to maintain that, play solid defense, you know, and keep them in front of us, and we got to be able to box out. And those are pretty much the keys. We, you know, both teams are going in to compete, and both teams are going in to win. And it comes down to who makes more baskets than the other. And I think, you know, we just need to go and really stay poised, which I think is going to be key for us. But we really have a lot of respect for Emmanuel, and we're excited that we're playing them, and we know that they're a really good team.
Your team being led by Maria Foglia, 15.1 points a game. You're getting 13-plus out of Kate Purcell. And those are your two big players, obviously, point-wise, because then it gets cut in half down to the next pair. Kate Purcell, mm-hmm. though, obviously 6.5 rebounds as well. And those two players alone have totaled up 133 assists for the team. Obviously, you've got those two. Tell us a little bit about what ticks with them and then what the rest of the squad brings to the table.
Yeah, well, I think every player on our team is big, not just Maria and KP, but really every player. And that's one thing that I think is really special about us. You know, Maria and KP, yeah, we need them to score. We want the ball in their hands, and, you know, our team really understands, you know, what our needs are. But it's not just about Maria and KP, and I know I'm so excited that they're on our team, obviously, and not on some other team. But you know, the great thing about us is throughout this entire season and why we're 22-5 is people have stepped up. When, you know, when the going gets tough and there's been a lot of pressure on Maria and KP, which there's going to be, players have stepped up on this team. And I'm not just saying players out there on the court. I'm talking about our bench, too, getting the players out on the floor excited. And that's what's been really special about us, that it's not just always one player or two players. We always have somebody stepping up. Sometimes it's somebody that you expect, and sometimes it's somebody random. And me as a coach, I'm not really sure who that person is going to be, but that's what they've been doing all year long, and I'm pretty proud of that.
Well, Maria, we should point out, first team Empire 8 Conference, and KP, a second team pick, along with the rest of the team. A 12 win difference between last year and this year. I was reading your bio. You have a knack for this. You took over a team that hadn't won a game in three seasons. You get three wins, and the next thing you know, a couple of years later, they're winning the conference title in NAIA. You've come in here. You've certainly made waves with Hartwick, and 12-win swing is certainly impressive in anybody's book. What's been the secret from your point of view?
Well, my big thing is, I always want to do things in a respectful way, and you have to get the right players in order for that to happen. And I think, you know, our staff has done a really good job of going out and recruiting the right players to build a program. And it takes special players, very unselfish players, to do that. And we work really hard at that, and I think we have those type of players. And they're very, very passionate about the game. They spend a lot of extra time in the gym and do a lot of little things that make us who we are and has made us successful. And, if you don't get those type of players, you're going to struggle. So it starts with recruiting and finding the right players that fit your style. And, you know, I'm very passionate. Basketball has been my entire life, and I really don't know my life without it. And I need players that have that same passion and that same desire. And we've found a group. We have 14 players, and we have, a manager, and I have two other assistant coaches that have been unbelievable, that have helped us get to where we are. And I have to give a lot of credit to my two assistant coaches, Danielle Parks and Bobby Z, that have taught me. I mean, I'm only in my eighth year of coaching, and there's still so much that I have to learn. And we do this all together. And I'm really excited about that. And, you know, nobody knows more than the other, and we just bat ideas off with each other and even with our players. And we want to do whatever it is to help us be successful. And I think that's kind of what my philosophy is building a program and getting it to, you know, to be really good.
Well, it's really interesting. You played in New York State and had a very successful career in high school. And then you went on to Duke University. Not too bad. played a lot there. Had two ACC tournament titles, three regular season squads. You got to the Elite Eight once and Sweet 16 once, or actually twice, obviously. And then you came, and you actually played professionally over in Germany, and then came back into coaching. You point out 8 years here in coaching. What do you think you bring from such a huge Duke program experience, and then playing overseas as well? What does that bring to the table?
To be honest, playing and coaching are two completely different things. But I think, you know, having that background, I know what basketball can do to a student athlete. It can make you confident. It can help you in when you go out and get a job. It can help you just your everyday life. And I think that's the biggest lesson that basketball has taught me, really how to live. And, you know, I don't coach because of the basketball or, for the wins and losses, but I love spending time with my players and helping them develop the skills for life after basketball. And I think that's what I learned the most from playing at Duke. That's the most that I learned from playing overseas, is that, you know, through a game, you can learn the life skills. And for me, this is such a huge part of our student athletes' lives. And to be able to spend pretty much every day with these players is something that I do not take for granted, and it's something that I really hold dear to me. And they're, you know, they're kind of like my own kids. And I know that I need to take care of them and you know, help them become successful in the future. And that's really what, you know, Duke has taught me, to be completely honest. Yes, the passion. Yes, you can't go to Duke if you don't love basketball. I mean, that's just the way it is. And you definitely can't play on the team if you don't. But it's all the other things away from the court. And those are the things that, you know, what I've learned the most.
Talking to Missy West here of Hartwick. Coach, Hartwick's not exactly the easiest place to be located in upstate New York. I've been there a few times. It's on the side of a hill, and that might be being generous. Oneonta State is you can see the campus from the other campus. What's it like to be coaching up there in the upstate New York area and in Division III, considering your background in other areas?
Well, the best thing about my job is that I actually work in heaven. You know, once you get to the top of Hartwick's campus, I'm pretty much in heaven.
Well, you've worked hard enough to get there. It should be, right?
That's right. But, I mean, Hartwick's fun, and what I like about it is athletics is really, really important. We have a lot of support from our president, from our AD, from the other athletic programs, and I think that's really important. You know, I would not be at Hartwick if I didn't feel that way, because I'm too passionate about athletics, and I think we have that. And, you know, to be honest, my players make it enjoyable for me every single day. I mean, I get to go to heaven, and I get to spend two and a half hours with these players that just drive me and make me a better coach, you know. And so I love what I do. I love that at this level, family is really important. It's not just about the basketball game, which has been my entire life. And, you know, so I get to have some time with my parents, which is nice, and my brothers and their little nieces and nephews, and that's something that I've never had in the past. So this level, there's a lot of pluses, and you got to play for the love of the game, not for the money.
That is true. and quickly, Hartwick, on both the men's and women's side dancing, what's the atmosphere mm-hmm. been like on campus?
It's been awesome. I'm so proud of both our team and the men's team, and you know, they have a big battle against Farmingdale tomorrow. It's just been really exciting. Students are really excited about it. You know, unfortunately, the last two weekends, both being in the Empire 8 tournament and different sites, it's been hard to see all the excitement at Hartwick because we've always been on the road. But I know through emails, I know through text messages, I know through articles that have been written and people staying in touch with me, and everybody's just really, really excited. I mean, this is big for having both men's and women's program first go to the Empire 8 tournament and then both get a bid to the NCAAs. That's big. So we're all really, really excited about it.
We appreciate you joining us here on Hoopsville. I certainly appreciate you taking the time. As always, we give the coach the final word here on the show. Any final thoughts you'd like to share with those who are listening tonight?
Well, first, I would just want to thank you for having me on D3 Hoops and everything that you do for Division III basketball. I think it's really big, and I think, you know, speaking for everybody, I think everybody really appreciates all that you do. And I, you know, I just want to say a group of people that I have not said anything to is the parents. Another thing that makes our program really successful is the support that we have from parents and from fans and from friends. They follow us everywhere. I know they're all going to be here tomorrow night supporting us, and they've been driving all over. So I thank them and everything that they've done for us. It's just been great. And I want to wish Todd and his team great luck tomorrow night.
Very good. Well, congratulations on making the NCAA tournament. Good luck against Emmanuel. And we will look forward to seeing how if you can get out of this weekend, where you may go after that.
Thanks so much. I appreciate it.
No problem. Take care.
Right.
Missy West joining us from Hartwick. And by the way, you know, we should mention we have Gary Fifield coming up later from Southern Maine. We should point out that on this, you know, tournament, or I should say what Hartwick will face is 35th year coach Andy Yasinoff. He has a 683-224 record. That's a 753 winning percentage. That is third and fourth best all time in Division III. That is pretty impressive. So it'll be Missy West with 8 years of coaching against Andy Yasinoff with 35 years of coaching experience. That'll be fascinating to watch if you get the chance. Again, Hartwick women's basketball, 22-5 on the season. They finished with an at-large bid. And I'm sorry, Yasinoff, I should say. But they finish, we'll take on Emmanuel at 6 o'clock. Tomorrow evening, that game at Rhode Island College. Let's go back to the Hoopsville hotline very quickly for a score update from our good friend Frank Rossi as his game has come to an end. Frank, welcome back to the Hoopsville hotline.
Does this make me the first official final of the tournament?
It probably will, yes.
Because St. Mary's and Bethany's are still going at it, I believe
so.
Anyway, yep, NYU has pulled it out here, 84-65 over Misericordia.
in this first round game. Yes, it's Thursday night game, one of the two, as we, I'm sure, have said throughout the show. And at halftime, it was the other way around. Missouri Concordia had a 1-point lead, 37-36, but 68% shooting performance by NYU versus 30.8% in the second half for Missouri Concordia.
Wow.
That's what turned things around. At the 13-16 mark in the second half, it was a 2-point game, 48-46 in favor of NYU. Then they went on a 10-0 run and closed out the game overall from that 13-16 mark at 36-19 over Missouri Concordia. I think the big story here is where things went right for Missouri Concordia in the first half, they went wrong in the second half, because their star on the first half was Ethan Eichhorst, who had 17 points 16 minutes into the game. He didn't score again for 17 minutes in this game. He ended with 22 points, and those next points came on technical free throws. So you can see how ineffective he became in the second half. You shut down a force like that, and you're going to have your way with a team, and that's what happened for NYU. And Carl Yaffe, the story of the second half really for that team, 14 points in the second half alone, 21 points overall. And also in double figures, Andy Stein, 14 points for NYU, Kyle Stockmall, 10 points. Those are the starters who all had double digits for NYU. On the other side, Joe Busaka had 17 points for Missouri Concordia. Turnovers also did in Missouri Concordia in the second half, 10 turnovers to 7 for NYU in the second half. So pretty clean game the first half, been a little more sloppy in the second half. A lot of crowd support, and I got to be honest, I think home court advantage did mean a lot here, because you had NYU versus Missouri Concordia just going back and forth until that 13-minute mark in the second half. Finally, it looked like NYU had adrenaline and Missouri Concordia didn't.
Quickly, before we let you go, obviously NYU, a very difficult place to play, according to all sources. I have not been there to see it in firsthand, but how much did the crowd, how much did the energy in the gym have a factor in the second half against Missouri Concordia?
I think it really did eventually have an effect. Missouri Concordia's fan base was a lot smaller, a lot less vocal because of, you know, just the outnumbered nature of the situation. Remember, it's a Thursday night game day, so it's tough, you know, when you're from Pennsylvania to get your crowd out to New York City on short notice like this. So I think these Thursday first-round games, you get an extreme effect like that where the home court is going to be absolutely saturated by home fans, and that's what happened here in that 84-65 final in favor of NYU, who advances to, that little team named Amherst,
yeah,
number two in the D3Hoops.com Top 25 poll.
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much for joining us. I appreciate it. I know you enjoyed the game. Go ahead and rest up. You've got a busy weekend ahead of you.
Absolutely. Thanks, Dave.
All right, take care. Frank Rossi joining us from NYU, where NYU defeats Missouri Concordia. Our first results of the NCAA Division III men's basketball tournament. They will take on Amherst, as Frank mentioned, that game on Saturday, scheduled, I believe, for 7, but I also thought I read 8, and I'll admit I did not double-check the time. Also, a quick scoring update. Bethany goes on a 17-6 run and now trails St. Mary's 66-57. At one point, actually, I should say 65-57. It was 63-57, but still a 17-6 run to claw back into the game. I believe there's about 3 minutes left. I'm sorry, a little under 2 minutes left in that one. We'll keep you score update on that as well. We've got to take a commercial break. On the other side, we will talk to... There's the broadcast. Sorry, folks. It's Chris monitoring the show, making sure everything goes okay. We're on the other side. We'll talk to St. Thomas, the defending champs, and talk about their entering into the NCAA tournament this year. You're listening to Hoopsville, presented by D3Hoops.com. We'll be back after this.
Amber alert, abducted child, African-American girl, 6 years old, suspect wearing blue shirt, black jeans.
Now when an Amber alert is issued, you can get the same information the authorities get right on your cell phone. Sign up for free at wirelessamberalerts.org. Think of it, something as simple as a free text message could free an abducted child.
All units, Amber alert canceled. Child recovered safely. Suspect is in custody.
wirelessamberalerts.org. A child is calling for help. Brought to you by the Ad Council.
So, EJ, we've designed you a signature shoe worthy of a three-time All-American with mad smarts and sick leadership skills. Ta-da!
There are over 380,000 NCAA student-athletes.
Yeah, you got your GPA embossed, right?
I love it.
And just about all of them will be going pro in something other than sports.
Can I get it in a loafer for casual Fridays?
Yes. Yes.
Who are you?
Who can make you cheer?
And play your fight song?
Who can bring you to your feet?
Or bring you to your knees?
When the game is on the line, who do you want to take the last shot?
NCAA basketball. Who's your team? NCAA Women's College Basketball. All day, every day, our game. These women can really play. Filling it up, knocking them down, and bringing it home. It's basketball at its purest. For family fun and great entertainment, there's nothing like it. All day, every day, our game. NCAA Women's College Basketball.
And welcome back to Hoopsville. I'm your host, Dave McHugh. Welcome back, and hope you are all well. We are working to get Johnny Tarr from St. Thomas on the line. We will do that here shortly. If you have any questions for us, email us at hoopsville at d3hoops.com. That is hoopsville at d3hoops.com. It was also email address. As I said, AOLIM is your AOLIM address, Hoopsville 2000. Let's see here. Just going through things, making sure we didn't miss anything. By the way, I forgot to mention this last weekend. Thank you very much for letting us get over the 1,000 mark well in advance of today. We are now at 1,058 followers, I believe, give or take a few. Keep coming. We appreciate you following us. We hope you will be following us as well. We do know this about the St. Thomas Tommies. They enjoyed a nice pregame meal this evening. so hopefully we'll be hearing from their coach after that wonderful meal here shortly. Apparently not. We will keep trying him, and if we miss him, we miss him. Again, email us at hoopsville at d3hoops.com. AOLIM is Hoopsville 2000. Your Twitter address is D3Hoopsville. That's at D3Hoopsville or hashtag Hoopsville. Facebook.com/Hoopsville. And, of course, there's the chat room alongside if you happen to be watching us on the Ustream site, and we certainly appreciate anybody who may be doing that. Again, we already have our first win in the books as NYU defeats Misericordia easily, and it is over at St. Mary's. Last I saw, it was about 38 seconds left, and St. Mary's had weathered the storm. It was at least 68-57. We will double-check that here shortly. But St. Mary's weathering a 17-6 run by Bethany in that second half from what had been essentially looking like they were blowing the doors off, 57-40. Final score 69-57. So after getting to within six at 63-57, Bethany unable to score in the last 3 minutes of the ball game, roughly outscored 6-0 and win 69-57 for the St. Mary's Seahawks. Devin Spencer with 28 points. Pretty impressive for Spencer, who last year played behind some pretty good players. 7-for-11 from beyond the arc. That's a St. Mary's squad that even I didn't think would win that game, and I'll be honest with you. I thought that maybe the depth would hurt them. They are on to play Virginia Wesleyan in the second round. They will play at 7 o'clock in Virginia Beach. And then, as we mentioned earlier, NYU defeating Misericordia rather easily. They will take on Amherst coming up on Saturday. We are double-checking the time there. Still no luck there, my man. Wow. Hopefully we'll get St. Thomas on the line here. A couple things to keep of note coming up. We still have plenty of guests. On the other side, or coming up soon, Castleton men's basketball coach Paul Culpo will join us. School of the Week, the City of Salem School of the Week, and then Misericordia's women's basketball coach on the interim basis, former men's basketball coach, athletics director, and former NCAA Division III men's basketball committee chair Dave Martin will join us on the line. Carthage women's basketball coach Tim Bernero will join us, and Southern Maine's women's basketball coach Gary Fifield will join us as well. That's all coming up in the next hour here on Hoopsville. We'll also try and get Pat Coleman on here to quickly go through the women's side and see who we think come out of the bracket this weekend. Quickly, to keep you informed of games, video, live stats, all of that, don't forget to go to d3hoops.com, especially tomorrow and Saturday. Just go to the the scores section, and you'll find live events, men's scores, or women's scores. Those are your options. Clearly, we will have lots of video links when available. There are some of us going to locations. Frank Rossi is going to William Patterson to do production for that school and its group of games. I am going to Transylvania to do production work for Transylvania and do their games. Pat Coleman will be at River Falls, Wisconsin River Falls, that is, and doing the games there as well. And there's lots of other schools like Wash U's and Amherst and the like who will also have video broadcasts. So any information we have on video links, live stream stats, any of that stuff, I should say live stats and video streaming, getting it all confused, we will make sure to get that to you on that page, and that is where you can, that's pretty much can be your NCAA tournament central location. And anything we don't have there now will certainly be updated in the next few hours as we either find ones that haven't been able to be updated or we look for others down the road. We're going to take another break. We have a blinking line. So we're not taking a break. We're going to wait just a little bit. Looks like our St. Thomas guest may be here, and we'll do a quick interview with him. Again, email us at Hoopsville at d3hoops.com. That's Hoopsville at d3hoops.com. You can IM us at Hoopsville2000 on your AOL IM or join us on the chat room right alongside. Twitter is at d3hoopsville and hashtag Hoopsville, and then facebook.com/Hoopsville. Those are your choices, and we will certainly love to hear from you. There's also a chat room if you're listening, watching the show actually on our Ustream page versus our d3hoopsville.com page on d3hoops. Chris, are we good? Let's jump into the West region, and Coach Johnny Tarr joins us from St. Thomas, the defending national champions on the men's side. Coach, welcome to Hoopsville.
Hey, thanks very much. Appreciate you having me on.
Well, I certainly appreciate you taking the time. Obviously, the defending national champs, you lost a lot from a squad coaching change in a sense. You've been on the coaching staff for a long time. But nonetheless, 21-6 on the season, 16-4 in the conference, get that automatic bid thanks to defeating Gustavus Adolphus, and you've won, I believe, 7 straight at this point in time. Looking pretty good going into the NCAA tournament.
Yeah, we're really excited. I think we're peaking at the right time, as are most of the teams that are in the tournament. But we've got a young group. We lost 5 great seniors, and obviously Coach Fritz, who is a mentor of mine and a legendary coach for so many years, and we're just excited to be here. Our guys play really, really hard, and we get after it defensively. So it should be a great game with Claremont tomorrow.
Quickly about that, Fritz, as you mentioned, retiring in the spring, though probably not a surprise to many. You had been an assistant under him for 11 years. You had been a player at St. Thomas as well, and already, by the way, already a Hall of Famer there at St. Thomas. By the way, you should mention Coach Fritz is still around as athletics director, and obviously that means a lot for both yours and the women's program. But what's it been like now to take over the helm, as it were, of this team, especially coming off a national title?
Yeah, certainly there's you can't really top that, and that's one of the things we've talked to our guys a lot about. This is a different team and a different year and different journey, and Coach Fritz has been unbelievable as a mentor and sounding board, and really, I think the things that we always pride ourselves on are playing basketball the right way and getting good, unselfish guys to buy in. And fortunately this year, we've had right now 6 of our top guys, are 6 of our top 10 are freshmen and sophomores. And so there have been some bumps in the road, some youthful inexperience, but a lot of it's combined with exuberance that makes plays. And so it's been, it's been a great ride so far. We hope to keep it going.
Talking to Johnny Tarr here of St. Thomas. Coach, first and foremost, obviously, the fact that you're in the NCAA tournament has got to be pretty fulfilling. You had a stretch there in the middle where it looked like it could be interesting. You get past Gustavus Adolphus, which certainly played some pretty good basketball in the MIAC. Now you're taking on a Claremont Mud Scripps team from California who has certainly been playing very good basketball from what everybody can tell. What have you seen on tape? What have you gathered from others, if you have, as you prepare against the CMS team? What do you see as your matchups? What do you see as your advantages or disadvantages?
Well, they're really good. We played Occidental and Pomona out in their conference early in the season to start our year. And, so we're a little familiar with that style of ball. They played St. Olaf from our conference, and who had a very good team. And Coach Scalmanini does a tremendous job. They play hard-nosed, tough defense, and they take good shots. I mean, they really – all around, they're a tough matchup. They've got a three-time conference player of the year and lots of good guys around them who can shoot it off the bench. So we're going to have our hands full, but we're, you know, it's fun to see teams you haven't throughout the year after the 20-game MIAC season and the playoffs. It's, you know, I think it's refreshing for all of us to see different styles of play. And you go into the game having a good sense of what they do, but certainly some of it's going to be adjusting on the fly. And as coaches, that's, you know, that's a unique challenge at this time of the year, too.
What do you think from seeing the video that you guys bring to the table that they may be a problem for them?
Well, you know, we pride ourselves on our depth and being able to play up tempo. And so we hope that, you know, we always like to hope that we can cause turnovers. And, you know, much of what we do is predicated on just getting easy shots, and they're gonna keep us in front of them pretty well. And so we're gonna, you know, I think what it'll come down to is who's able to get easy baskets. At this time of the year, you don't see many teams you're gonna get easy backdoors on or easy lobs over the top. And so, you know, my hunch is the team that gets five or six easies is the one that's gonna win.
Let's talk about your team. Will DeBerg's the leading scorer at 12.9 points, but of course, John Nance, the top return man from that national championship team with 11.8 points. 3.9 rebounds, shooting 45% from the floor. You're also getting contributions, as you mentioned, from a number of other guys, Zach Reideman, Noah Kaiser, et cetera, et cetera. Of course, you did have Tommy Hannon coming back, but he got injured halfway through the season. So there's been some adjustments along the way. Tell us a little bit about how these players, you alluded to it, but how these players have really stepped up.
Yeah, you know, Tommy was our only guy coming back with a lot of experience. And right. So when he went down and not having him the last 16 games, there's certainly a transition period. But, you know, the guys that you mentioned have stepped up. And like we told our guys, no one guy is going to be Tommy Hannon. He was leading us in points, rebounds, shooting percentage. He was our captain. And, you know, so really I think the fun part over the course of the year has been the growth we've seen in a lot of our young guys and how they've really played unselfishly. Been committed to, you know, nobody cares who scores. I mean, really, at the end of the day, I don't know that we have anybody in the top 15 in the conference in scoring or rebounding. We just run guys out there and they play their butts off and they trust each other. That's probably the biggest thing is they really do. They go into games knowing that if they move the ball, it's going to come back to them and vice versa. So
back to Tommy Hannon, there's been talk that if you guys make a deep run or even maybe even a little bit of a run here in the NCAA tournament, there is a chance we may or may not see him. What is his status for the NCAA tournament, and may it result in him coming back next year?
You know, he certainly, yeah, I think there's a possibility of both. I think his knee, he's got a bum knee, and it's a pretty tough deal because he was the heart and soul of our team, like I said. And he's been a great leader off the court. And, you know, I don't know that we'll see him back in the national tournament or not, and he could come back next year in terms of applying for a medical hardship. But, you know, that has a lot. He has a lot of decisions to make along that line, too. So really a lot of unknown.
Obviously taking on Claremont Mud Scripps. You're up at Whitewater, the Wisconsin Whitewater hosting location. You've certainly traveled quite a bit with this team over the years in the NCAA tournament. Last year in the sectional round, you guys were at Augustana. It seems like travel has at least gotten to be a little bit familiar for this Tommy squad.
Yeah, you know, a few years ago we were at Wheaton, and then we were at Carthage, and then last year going to Augustana. And so, yeah, I think there is something with familiarity, you know, that while it's still a bus trip and you got to go play on a foreign floor, I think there is a certain comfort level, as young as our guys are, that they, you know, this is sort of what they expect. And, you know, playing in games like this, it'll be an electric atmosphere at Whitewater. I mean, it's our first time here, and the complex is just incredible. So we're looking forward to a fun tournament throughout the weekend.
Beginning of the season, you actually went out to California and played Occidental and Pomona Pitzer, two teams that are in the conference for Claremont Mud Scripps, your opponent tomorrow night. Can you gather anything from those games and that experience that can also prepare this team for tomorrow night?
Well, I think the thing that, you know, in so many teams in Division III could be characterized this way, but they play really intelligent basketball. They've got good players who, you know, they don't beat themselves. Claremont's averaging 11 turnovers a game, which is a really low number. They're among the leaders in the country there. And they really, I mean, you look for things where, you know, how can we exploit something? And there's not a lot there that's really apparent. If there was, I probably wouldn't tell you over the internet anyways.
Understood.
But I can tell you they're really well coached. They're sound defensively and they take good care of the ball. So, you know, it's going to be a grinded out game. There aren't going to be a lot of games in the tournament. They're in the 80s, high 70s. It's going to be probably 50s and 60s, and whoever plays better possession basketball be in great shape.
Very good. Coach, I appreciate you taking time out of your night to join us here on Hoopsville. As always, we give the coach the final word. Any final thoughts you'd like to share with those who are listening?
Oh, you know, it's a pleasure to be on here, and I know on behalf of all of our team, we appreciate everything that you guys do at D3 Hoops. It's an exciting time of the year, and these guys have put in so much to, you know, the journey of the season and bumps and bruises and injuries and adversity. And so for us to get a chance to play and get a chance to talk a little bit with you tonight, it's just an honor and privilege, and we thank you for all your support.
Well, thank you very much. Congratulations on a very successful first season, and good luck tomorrow night against Claremont Mudscripts.
Thank you very much. Have a great night.
All right, take care. Johnny Tarr joining us from St. Thomas. Appreciate him joining us. Again, winners of seven straight, and they will take on Claremont Mudscripts here shortly, and we congratulate them for that. Getting our school of the week on the line here quickly. Castleton will be joining us. In the meantime, if you have any questions, email us at hoopsville at d3hoops.com. That's hoopsville at d3hoops.com. You can IM us at hoopsville2000 on your AOL IM. Join us on Twitter. We'll be happy to have you there. And you can also, that's at D3 Hoopsville, at D3 Hoopsville, or hashtag Hoopsville, or AOL, I'm sorry, I keep reading the top of my screen. Or join us on Facebook at facebook.com/Hoopsville. And, of course, you can also join us in the chat room alongside the show if you are watching us actually on Ustream. If not, that's all right. You got other avenues. By the way, I want to thank all of you also for making Sunday night a record night on Hoopsville. Had most of you unique viewers of the show that I can think of in the last few years, especially since we put the show on Ustream. So I want to thank you. Well over 1,100 of you tuned in to Hoopsville during its four-hour broadcast on Sunday, and we certainly thank you for that. Now time to jump to our City of Salem School of the Week. City of Salem, obviously the host of the Division III Men's Basketball Championship Tournament, and they hopefully want you, to hopefully come to Salem to see the Final Four in men's basketball. In the meantime, they are a proud sponsor of the School of the Week, and the School of the Week this week is Castleton State and their men's basketball coach. Paul Copel joins us on the show. Coach, welcome to Hoopsville.
Thanks for having me.
I appreciate you taking the time. 19-9 on the season, 15-3 in the conference being the NAC. You beat Colby Sawyer 102-76 to get that automatic qualifier, and you should be outside the Philadelphia area on this evening as you will take on Cabrini tomorrow night.
That's correct. We're in Philly, ready to go.
Have you had a cheesesteak yet, just out of curiosity?
It's the first thing we do when we got here. I had a couple kids on the team that never had them before, and so I made sure I got that one done immediately.
Very good. Did you go to anywhere special, or just made sure you got the cheesesteak?
No. You know, I have some friends that live down in this area, yeah. So they had recommended a couple places, so I just called one of them, and they delivered them to the hotel, and
great.
That was that.
Wonderful. Perfect.
Yeah.
Hey, you guys would, let's say you're the other Vermont team. The one that gets all the attention is certainly Middlebury. There are three schools traveling to Middlebury. You seem to be the only Division III leaving Vermont this weekend.
That's okay with us. They're pretty good.
Yeah, well, they are. But you guys are pretty solid. By the way, I shouldn't forget about Norwich, as Pat Coleman reminds me. But obviously, you're in the NCAA tournament. A rough start to the season, losers of 4 out of 6. A little tough stretch in the middle, but then you kind of righted yourself in the conference, rolled through the conference, and won the automatic bid. What has the season been like from your point of view?
Well, the season's been really, first of all, you know, such a different style of play than what we've done in the past. And so that alone has made it quite an experience. But, you know, we started out the year, and truthfully, if you look back at the early part of our season and the way we were playing then compared to how we're playing now, it's really not the same. So, you know, there's been some ups and downs, but, you know, the beginning of the year also, part of it was some of the teams we were playing are pretty good.
Yeah, well, you know, you certainly played a tough schedule. You had some William, you know, Springfield, WPI. You had, I'm sorry, I'm skipping through the schedule, so forgive me. Williams and Skidmore, and yeah. Certainly others along the lines as well that have been a pretty solid schedule there for you. One thing that certainly comes to mind when a lot of people look at the stats and look at how many players are playing, it almost looks like you're playing the quintessential system. That Grinnell has made famous in Division III, and certainly Loyola Marymount made famous in the first place. You're playing a lot of guys most of the time. You're getting a lot of contributions, though, led by Mark Comstock and Greg Hughes, 17.3, 13.6, and Logan White at 10 points a game. Should mention Comstock's pulling in 7 rebounds. Are you playing a system? Are you playing a variation of the system? What is the deal?
Well, as I tell everybody else that's asked me about it, it would be an insult to Grinnell to say that we're playing like Grinnell. I think what they do it to a whole different level. But we certainly have stolen some of their ideas and concepts and things together that best fit our personnel. You know, I don't know how Grinnell does it. I mean, I watch some of their clips and it's just overwhelming. So, you know, I wish if people went to the game and said, geez, they play just like Grinnell, I'd take it as a great compliment. But I think at this point, you know, it wouldn't be fair to them. But we're somewhere past the normal basketball program, but we're not quite where Grinnell is.
Is this a system you plan to use in the future? Is it something that is working? Are you just playing with it? How long have you been using this?
Just started this year. I just made the determination that with this particular group of players that I had coming back, that it was going to give us our best chance to win the conference. I've never played it before. In fact, really, my teams were almost the opposite. We were pretty methodical and a lot of zone defenses and slowed games down and kind of grinded it out. So it's been a radical change for myself. It's been interesting. You know, we had early in the year, our first league game was at Maine Farmington, and we got beat badly. And I remember walking off the court that night, and I probably felt worse that night than any night I've ever felt as a coach because, you know, it's one thing getting beat when you play the way you believe you should play the game. When you lose badly and you're not even doing something you believe in, it's really hard. And that was a real low point for me personally. And that was the only point in the season where I thought, you know what, I was ready to pull the plug and just go back to doing what I knew best. But I got talked off the ledge by some other people. And, you know, we turned around the next day and have a huge win on the road against Thomas, who was picked to win the league. And from that point on, I knew I wasn't going to deviate, you know, from it. So, you know, to answer your question as far as the future, I don't know. But I know for this particular group, it's the way to play.
Talking to Coach Colpo here of Castleton State men's basketball, our City of Salem School of the Week, and we appreciate him joining us. Coach, you obviously ahead of you have Cabrini. They're just a little bit of a different squad. Clearly, you know, the system, your variation of it will certainly come into play. You've seen videotape. What do you think of their system? How do you think you match up, et cetera, et cetera?
Well, first of all, I think they're really good. I didn't know much about them, obviously, when the draw came out. And, you know, I was hoping that we would draw a team that was a little more controlled and, you know, wants to play the game in the 60s. And instead, we drew a team that's quick and athletic and fast. And you know, their point guard's fast as any kid I've seen. So, yeah. You know, I don't think that's great for us. But, you know, at this point in the year, you're going to play a good team. So, you know, it is what it is.
Yeah, I was going to say, Corey Lemons will be certainly a fascinating matchup with your team. Defensively, you know, the scheme of the system is defensively give up a shot quickly so you can get going down the court. Or have you taken that part of the system to heart? Will you let Cabrini score at will, or are you guys a hybrid of that?
No, I'm sure they're going to get a lot of easy baskets on us. You know, we're going to try to get the ball in and go back down quickly and, you know, try to make the game as frenetic as we can make it. But, you know, like I said, that's a pretty fast and quick athletic team. I mean, I'm watching some tape on them, and a couple times I did the old rewind to make sure I was watching it, you know, make sure I really saw what I think I just saw. And there's times that they're getting the ball down the court in one or two dribbles, and you know, Lemons is passing off to somebody finishing at the rim, and 3 seconds are gone on the shot clock. So it's, you know, it's not the team I would have picked to play against, but, you know, it is what it is. You know, it is what it is.
You're making your second appearance in the NCAA tournament since 2004. What's the atmosphere been like on campus?
Well, I wasn't a part of 2004, so for me,
should have said the programs.
It's been great. I mean, we hosted along with our women for the conference, so it was just a wild weekend, and it was standing room only. I think everybody's really excited and you know, very supportive. So it's been a really, really good experience, and it's been great for the kids. You know, they worked hard, and they deserve to get some of this.
Absolutely. Well, congratulations to them. Coach, I don't know if you are aware, but as the City of Salem School of the Week, we get to have a little fun, and we hope you don't mind. My producer extraordinaire, Chris Taher, has done some hard work and has come up with 5 questions for the School of the Week. The leader in the clubhouse, I believe, is 4 out of 5. Nobody has done worse than 3 out of 5, including a first-year coach last week. Now, that being all said, Chris's questions are going to be based on Castleton State. They're going to be based on the men's program or the athletics program. He does like to dabble in alumni famous, and he likes to dabble a little bit in college reports like World News and others.
Oh,
so I'm just warning you, I don't know what comes out of this. I can tell you if there's a Cubs connection in any way, Chris is not allowed to use that. He's already been reprimanded by myself being a Chicago Cubs fan. But the rest, I don't know. I haven't heard the questions. So if you don't mind partaking and having a little fun, we got a quick fire 5 questions for you.
Okay.
And Chris joins us here now with those 5 questions. Chris, Coach Colpo is your victim.
All right, Coach, here we go. First question. Castleton was founded in 1787, making it one of the oldest colleges in the nation. Where does it rank all time? And hint, it's in the top 20.
Well, you're generous.
I get only one guess?
Only one guess.
I'm going to say 12.
18th is the correct answer.
All right.
I was
that's
as impressed.
Close, though. Only 6 off.
Yeah.
And I was impressed he gave you a hint.
Well, I got to start him off.
Yeah.
That's a tough one to start with.
Yeah, by the way, he usually started in the past easy. This year, he's taken on some weird
not
order.
Back.
There's just no sense to this at all.
All right, Coach. Number 2. Who coached the men's basketball team to a 68-18 record from 1983 to 1986? Stan the man Van Gundy is correct.
I think he should have stayed there. Nothing against you, Coach, but just saying the NBA's been tough.
He'd have a lot less stress.
Yes, he would. A lot less egos, too.
He'd be living in a lot smaller house.
Yeah, oh, this is true, and dealing with winter. So 1 out of 2, very good.
All right, Coach, number 3. Castleton started its football program in 2009. And is now the only public institution in Vermont offering the sport, since the University of Vermont has not had football since 1974. This makes Vermont one of only 2 states in the nation where the state university does not field a football team.
Hmm.
Name the other.
You gotta be kidding me.
I think I know this.
The only other state where the state university doesn't have football?
Correct.
If he doesn't get this, let me try.
How about Alaska?
Alaska's correct.
That was my choice.
Very nice, Coach.
Very well done, Coach.
That was an absolute guess.
Yeah, and it would have been a guess on my part just from deduction that really
right.
I don't remember ever having an Alaska football team in the conversation. So 2 out of 3, very good.
All right, number 4. This is, as Dave alluded to, the second NCAA tournament appearance for the men's basketball team. Which Castleton team has had the most appearances in the NCAA tournament?
Women's basketball?
It is women's, but it's women's soccer. It's actually had 3 appearances in the tournament.
Well, you know, I got to go with my man Tim Barrett. any of those kind of questions, I'm going to guess Tim.
2 out of 4, not bad. Last one on its way.
All right, Coach, here we go. Your squad is not the only Spartan team in the tournament this year. First of all, do you know what the other school is? That's not the whole question.
No, I thought that was the question. No, I did not know the other Spartan team.
The other Spartan is York.
York
College is the other Spartan team. Now, I thought it'd be fun to take a look at both schools. I have in front of me the career leading scorers at both schools. So I want you to tell me which Spartan has scored more points in their career, the Castleton leader or the York leader? And I can give you the names of both if you would like.
Well, I know our leader is Corey Anderson.
That's correct.
And so I'm going to go with my man because that I got to do that. I got to go with my Spartan. So I'm going to go with Corey Anderson.
Corey Anderson scored 1,900
or something, right?
1,922 points. It was very good. Dave, do you have a guess on who the York leading scorer is?
Pat and I are both on the agreement here. It's O'Brien, but I don't know what the total was.
Andy O'Brien, and he scored 2,001
points. Right.
In
he
his
went
career.
Over 2,000. I forgot about
so
that.
So close, 79 points separating the two. But I thought that was neat. 2 Spartans with big career numbers.
Absolutely. Well, Coach, you survived.
Well, yeah, but I'm down at the bottom and I only got 2 right.
No, that's all right. That's all right. You did better than 1, which nobody's done this season. So, you know, at least you're not there, and that's a good thing.
I'm much better at the shows like Quiz Show, where I actually get the questions ahead of time. With the answers, then I'm pretty good.
Yeah, I know a lot of people like that.
You know?
Hey, well, Coach, thanks so much for joining us. Good luck against Cabrini. Enjoy the Philadelphia area and the cheesesteaks. And obviously you will. You know him pretty well. And we'll look forward to seeing how you do tomorrow night. And good luck.
Okay, great. Thanks, guys.
All right. Oh, I'm sorry, Coach. I forgot the most important part here on Hoopsville.
Yeah.
We always give the coach the final word. Any final thoughts you want to share with those who are listening?
Yeah, anyone out there listening that supports Castleton, obviously they had a great year, and I appreciate that a great deal. It's been a good season, and certainly I would like to thank you guys not only for having me on, but just what you do for Division III basketball. There's some really good players and great coaches as well. And I certainly appreciate what you do.
Well, thank you for joining us. I appreciate that as well. And good luck.
Great. Thanks, guys.
Take care. Coach Paul Coppel.
Yep.
Joining us as our City of Salem School of the Week. Again, reminder, City of Salem in Salem, Virginia, just outside of Roanoke, Virginia, is the host of the Division III Men's Basketball Championship Weekend, as it has been for countless years. We will be down there as D3Hoops.com. We hope you will join us as well. Tickets are on sale. Just go to the NCAA Division III website, or D3Hoops.com, I should say. Go to D3Hoops.com for more information. Going to take a very quick break. We're behind schedule, but on the other side, we will jump over and talk to our good friend Dave Martin from Misericordia. You're listening to Hoopsville, presented by D3Hoops.com. Back after this.
Daddy, I'm only 3 years old, but when you look at me, I could see your wheels turning. You're dreaming about what am I going to be when I grow up? A major league first baseman? Maybe a point guard for a national championship team? Or the winner of the Heisman Trophy?
The odds of a child becoming a professional athlete? 1 in 16,000. The odds of a child being diagnosed with autism? 1 in 150. You know the odds of autism. Now learn some of the signs. No big smiles or other joyful expressions by 6 months. No back and forth sharing of sounds or facial expressions by 9 months. And no babbling by 12 months. To learn more of the signs and more about autism, visit autismspeaks.org.
So, Dad, let's keep dreaming the impossible while looking out for the possible, okay?
Brought to you by Autism Speaks and the Ad Council.
We've got more schools than Division I, more fans than Division II, and more upsets than March Madness. There's 800 programs with over 11,000 games leading to 2 national championships. And we've been covering it all for over a decade. From Eastern to Occidental, from Puget Sound to Piedmont, from Southwestern to the University of New England, and from Hope to Calvin. Nobody covers Division III basketball like we do. We're at D3Hoops.com at www.d3hoops.com.
And welcome back to Hoopsville. I'm your host, Dave McHugh. Chris Taher, our producer extraordinaire in the background. If you have any questions for us, email us at Hoopsville at D3Hoops.com. That's Hoopsville at D3Hoops.com. You can IM us at Hoopsville2000 on your AOL IM. You can join us on Twitter at D3Hoopsville or hashtag Hoopsville. You can also join us on Facebook at Facebook.com/Hoopsville or the chat room alongside us if you are watching us actually on our Ustream page. That pretty much covers all of that. We're a little bit behind schedule, so we're going to keep it moving. And joining us on the Hoopsville hotline is women's basketball interim coach Dave Martin, athletics director at Misericordia, former men's basketball coach, and former NCAA Division III men's basketball committee chair. I believe making him the first person ever to be the former national committee chair last year and be dancing in the NCAA tournament this year on the women's side, and he joins us on Hoopsville. Coach, welcome to Hoopsville.
Thanks, Dave. Pleasure to be here.
Usually we've talked to you at this time of year under very different circumstances. I'm usually grilling you about a bracket and selections and decisions by the NCAA tournament. This time I'm going to grill you about the fact that you took the team over on January 24th have led your alma mater, your team, your women's program into the NCAA tournament. And for that, we will give you a wonderful prize. You will take on Tufts at Tufts.
Yeah, that's a great prize, right?
Yeah.
No, I can tell you this, David. It's a lot. You know, I enjoyed my time as the on the national committee and as the committee chair. But this time of year is the best time of year if you're a basketball fan. But I'll tell you what, it's a lot more fun being on this side of it. than it was the other side of it. This has been great. It really has. It's been great.
Quickly let everybody know exactly what did develop and why you ended up being in the in basically on the sideline.
Well, our head women's basketball coach resigned for personal reasons back on January 24th. And at that time, you know, like most Division III schools, we have all part-time assistant coaches. And it was a situation where we felt it was important for our women to have the most quality experience they could have and to finish out the season the right way. Not that there wasn't enough going on our campus. We're starting football, and so you know my plate was pretty full with that. But we felt that the best solution was for me to step in and finish out the season as the interim head coach. And boy, you know the girls have been terrific. They were very accepting of me. The transition went very smoothly. The assistant coaches that we have, one of them, Albie Biggs, is a former player of mine. Ellen O'Brien, who's another one of our assistants, is our professional intern in athletics. She played at Denison, where she was a great player and has a master's degree in athletic administration from Ithaca. She's on our staff. And then the other gentleman, Scott Richardson, is a full-time employee on campus in our Diversity Institute. So those three people really helped make the transition smooth for me. But really, the girls have just been fantastic since I stepped into this role. We got on a little roll. We were 8-7, and after I took over, we went 9-3, and here we are. And it's been a lot of fun.
I got edged down for 9-7, but I'll take your word for it. I was going to point out that Coach Tim Griffith's last game was against Marywood, a win 74-57. I did notice your first game against Kings.
Actually, he didn't coach in that game.
Oh.
That
ruins the joke, Coach, because I was going to point out that your first game under the helm, they lost 51-44. Doesn't look like this went well to start.
Well, as I said, we took the attitude that this late in the season, I really wasn't going to come in and change anything. It was more about me adapting to them and just learning what we did offensively and defensively, and you know, we tweaked and fine-tuned a couple of things, but the girls have just been terrific. Their attitude has been outstanding. They bought into what I had to say, and it's really been a good situation.
Last quick question about this: obviously, you were removed from coaching for a little bit of a while, but still, you had what you did, and you had what your style was. How hard is it to come in and take over a program that already has its plays, already has its stuff in place, and you're the one who has to adapt?
Well, you know, a little bit challenging in the fact that I just didn't know what some of our calls were. You know, one of the advantages that I had was Coach Griffith, who resigned. He was actually my assistant before I became the AD. He was an assistant of mine for 4 years. So some of the things that he was running, we ran. They just called them something different, that's all. So there was a little bit of a learning curve there. But, you know, I've been involved in college basketball for 27 years, so the game really hasn't changed that much. The terminology has changed a bit, but there isn't much that when you're around that long, there isn't much that you haven't seen. So it took me a little bit of time to learn our calls and that type of thing. But, again, I give a lot of credit to our assistants. But it's worked out really well. It's been a lot of fun.
Let's talk about your team. Christine Marks leads it with 19 points a game and 10.4 rebounds a game. Even along with 40 steals, shooting 45%. Hannah Seeley, 11.3. Jesse Robinson and Tyan McDaniel at 11.1 points a game. Those are the big four. Should also mention Seeley's pulling in 7 rebounds, and the big assist king is Tyan McDaniel. But all four of those I just mentioned are contributing in the assist category as well. What has been this team's strength? What is the secret for this team on offense and defense?
Well, I think you just named the four keys to this team. Chris Marks, Hannah Seeley, Ty McDaniel, and Jesse Robinson have been great. You know, last year we played for a conference championship and lost down at the Sales, and those four kids were all in the starting lineup. They all played last year, so they've brought great experience. They've brought great leadership, and they, you know, we started the season with a motto, one team, one dream. And, you know, we've kept that alive. We felt that that was important to continue that. The girls, you know, their dream hadn't changed, even though the coach did. And we really put the focus on that. And those four kids have just been terrific. The leadership has been great. You know, Marks is a terrific player. She's leading as our school's all-time leading scorer and leading rebounder. Hannah Seeley is one of the most athletic females I have seen play Division III basketball. I mean, she is a terrific athlete. Ty McDaniel can really shoot the three, and she's a tough competitor. And Jesse Robinson has really been, I think, the glue for us. She is a tough kid. Every single night, she draws the other team's best offensive player. You know, she just works so hard at the defensive end. And she has, you know, one of the things we talked about, it doesn't matter who scores as long as we score. And I think that we've gotten a little more balance. You know, Christine is still our offensive leader. But I think that if you look at that last 12 games, we've gotten a little more balance. And I think Jesse Robinson is the young lady that has really stepped it up at the offensive end for us and made a bigger contribution. And that, you know, those four kids have really been the key to this team, though, without question.
I should also mention Katie Drayton, the second leading minutes on this team. Also the second leading assist person with 71, along with 28 steals. Coach, you've seen Tufts on video. You've certainly done your scouting already for the game tomorrow. It's a tough squad. That was a mouthful. what have you seen about them that you are working, not working on, but what have you seen about them that you are taking note of, and how do you think you guys will match up with them?
You know, they are very, very good, and they play in a great conference. I want to say that they're 21-6 maybe, and I think two or three of their losses are to Amherst, who we all know is the number one team in the country. So they're terrific, and they lost to Amherst in their conference final. But
right.
They're very, very good defensively. They really guard, and it's nothing fancy. They get up in you, and they challenge you. Let's go. But, you know, it's all man to man. But they're very, very good defensively, and they're very balanced. You know, they play nine kids, and all nine of those kids, their minutes are between 15 and 29 a game. So they're deep, and they're very balanced. All nine of those kids that play are averaging between 5.5 and 9.5 points a game. So there's no one player that you say, geez, you know, you've got to shut this kid down. They have good balance, and if you look through their 27 games that they've played, they've had varied leading scores. So they're very good. You know, they guard you. They're strong with the basketball. They like a lot of the dribble drive offense where they try to break you down, get in the lane, and then if you help, and you don't rotate, they kick it, and they've got some young ladies that can knock down the three. So there's no question we'll have our hands full tomorrow. But I told our kids tonight when we went through scouting report at our walkthrough, you know, they defend like us. They play the same style of defense that we do, and offensively they're very similar in the way that they play to Kings. So it's a style that we're certainly familiar with. The thing that remains to be seen is if obviously they're very, very talented, and we'll see how we perform tomorrow night.
Kings, who finished number one in the region, or I should say in the MAC Freedom League, at 13-1, 22-5 overall, and of course you beat them 64-54 at Kings to win the conference crown and get the automatic bid and go against Tufts. Coach, I appreciate you taking the time to join us. As you know, we always give you the final word. Any final thoughts you want to share with those who are listening?
Now, the one thing I would like to say, and it's not necessarily about our women's team, but I know our men's team just got beat by NYU
yep.
tonight in their opening round game. And I would really just like to congratulate Trevor Woodruff and our men's team. What a great year. 21 wins. They had won 12 in a row coming into tonight's game. Trevor's done a great job with our men's program. Those kids have worked hard. And, you know, the last week has been great for Miss Recording University. We won both the men's and women's conference championships in basketball, and to do it, you know, we're right there in close proximity to Kings and Wilkes, and our men beat Wilkes in the final, we beat Kings in the final, and just a lot of excitement in the Wilkes-Barre area, and I really just wanted to congratulate Trevor and his team. I know that they're disappointed right now, and they got beat by a very, very good NYU team, but what a great year, and what a great basketball season for the Cougars.
Absolutely. Well said, and congratulations to both squads, and good luck tomorrow against Tufts. We'll obviously keep an eye on you, and again, at this rate, I think you might be the women's basketball committee chair at some point in time. Have you talked to your athletics director about getting the interim tag removed? Of course, your athletics director would be your wife.
That's exactly right. Well, that's funny. You know, a lot of the guys from the committee last year, and you know them all well,
yep.
David. Several of them told me that I ought to go talk to my AD and see if I can get the interim tag removed. But, you know, I'd like to think that the AD is a little smarter than that. And I'm sure that the AD can find someone that will do a better job with the basketball program than I would. So as soon as this ends, and hopefully not too soon, but as soon as this ends, we'll begin our search. We'll do a national search, and we'll find the right person to lead our women's program.
Very good. Well, Coach, I appreciate you taking the time. I'll certainly talk to you in the near future, and good luck.
Thanks, David. Thanks very much.
No problem. Dave Martin joining us from Misericordia, the interim women's basketball coach. He is the athletics director, as we mentioned, as well. We're going to waste a little time, get our next guest on the Hoopsville hotline here shortly, Tom Bernero. Will join us, Carthage women's basketball coach. In the meantime, if you have any questions for us, email us at hoopsville@d3hoops.com. That's hoopsville@d3hoops.com. You can IM us at hoopsville2000 on your AOL IM, or join us on Twitter @d3hoopsville. That's @d3hoopsville or #hoopsville. Go to facebook.com/hoops for more information on the show. You can also go to d3hoopsville.com. And if you're listening to the show and you're on our Ustream page, feel free to join us in the chat room there as well. Again, as he alluded to, Coach Martin did. Misericordia loses to NYU in the first round of the Division III men's basketball tournament. And also in the first round of the Division III men's basketball tournament, St. Mary's upends Bethany, withstanding a monstrous run by Bethany late in the game, and wins that one. So St. Mary's of Maryland will head down to Virginia Wesleyan to play the second round game on Saturday, and NYU will head up to Amherst for the second round game of that one. By the way, I should also mention, Dave did not allude to it, but a very interesting situation. We talked about how on the Amherst side, on the men's and women's, the one scenario we could see where the women could host, since men have the first right of a refusal, we'll say, was if the men got a bye. And the men did get a bye. So the women are hosting at Amherst this weekend. Two games tomorrow and then one game on Saturday. The men will play at 6. The women will play at 8. What was interesting that I never considered was what that does for practice schedules. You know, the NYU now has to travel to Amherst and practice tomorrow and get ready for their game on Saturday. Well, that has an effect on the fact that there's women's games tomorrow as well. And so, you know, you've got an extra team in there that you normally wouldn't have. And whether that's a perfect remedy to what we had thought would be a kind of cool scenario, I don't know. But it's certainly one that it has come up in conversation that I've heard in the last few days, and maybe something they'll reevaluate in the postseason. Let's stay on the women's basketball theme, and we're going to join, get back onto the Hoopsville hotline, and Coach Tim Bernero joins us from Carthage. Coach, welcome to Hoopsville.
Thanks. How are you guys doing tonight?
Doing pretty well. How are you?
Good. We're roaming around Greencastle, Indiana right now, so
yeah,
getting
ready
for tomorrow.
Going to say, you guys are at DePaul, where DePaul will be playing Westminster of Missouri. You will get to play Wisconsin Whitewater after a 20-7 season and 10-4 finish in the conference, though a tough loss to Illinois Wesleyan by 1 in the conference title game. Do you worry that that has any after effect?
No, I think we played pretty good basketball last weekend, and you know, just it was one of those things, I guess. We played Illinois Wesleyan 3 times, and they beat us by a total of 6 points. So I don't know if they should be playing the lottery or where I should be hiding from something. I don't know, because the games were all, you know, head-to-head and nose-to-nose for 40 minutes. And giving credit, they were able to win all 3 of them this time. So we'll, but we feel pretty good about ourselves. And, you know, we were the old proverbial on the bubble there on Sunday and Monday. And, you know, I think when we found out at 1:30 Monday, our kids were pretty excited and, you know, got another chance to play, and they're looking forward to tomorrow night.
Interesting season that you had. You had Chicago early on, lost to them by 19. We've seen what Chicago has done. Lost to Co, who certainly had a great season this year, by 6. You did go to Las Vegas, where you had a really successful weekend, I would say, beating DeSales by 6 and then beating a River Falls team that certainly looked pretty darn good by 7. Then conference action took place. Illinois Wesleyan and Wheaton tripped you up twice. Then Wheaton and Illinois Wesleyan tripped you up twice. Those are your back-to-back losses before Illinois Wesleyan got you again. What has this season taught this team? What has this team learned from the season? Or not even learned, but what has the team developed during this season that gets them to this game?
Yeah. You know, we really go out and try to challenge ourselves, like you mentioned, some of the teams we played. You know, we played St. Norbert, who wins the Midwest Conference more often than not and got tripped up in the conference tournament. You know, Wisconsin Lutheran, who won that league, and they're in the tournament. And you know, you guys put together a heck of a tournament in Las Vegas. I think, if I remember, of the 9 women's teams, 5 are in the NCAA tournament. So,
I think you're right.
You know, the Sales is a traditionally pretty good in their league, and you know, River Falls had a great year also this year. So we got, you know, I think we've lost to 4 teams, somebody told me. We lost to the Cole in Chicago in the non-conference and Wheaton and Wesleyan in the conference. And I think when you go out and play all those teams, you try to get disparate, you know, different types of games. I mean, we've got played some physical teams. We played some teams that are a little slow you down a little bit. We played teams that pressed. And you do that, and you can't always plan it that way, but when you get that, you get to that, you, as you get into this time of year, you've got a frame of reference. You can tell your kids, hey, remember when we played River Falls? You know, they're going to play like that. Or they're going to, you know, Whitewater will play like so-and-so. And so I think they have a comfort level of saying, hey, we've been challenged at the higher level of Division III women's basketball, and, you know, there's nothing we haven't seen, and now it's just a matter of, you know, performing tomorrow night and hopefully getting a chance to perform again on Saturday.
Obviously taking on a tough squad in Wisconsin Whitewater. You've seen the tape. You've obviously done your scouting. What do you think of the matchup? What do you think your team has as an advantage?
You know, we ran into them 2 years ago at their place in the NCAA tournament and beat them. And, you know, there's only a few people left on each team from that game. So, you know, they're going to try to play the game fast and press. And, you know, we just saw that last weekend with Illinois Wesleyan. So I think we're confident and comfortable with against that kind of style. You know, they've got some pretty good perimeter players. They've got good balance. I mean, they try to get the ball to the basket, and they've got a post, you know, Fumero kid in the post. It's a good offensive player, and you know, we think we've got a pretty balanced offensive team too. We've got some good shooters on the perimeter, and Danny Ripke and Allison Grossel, and then Diana Jacklin, who's played, I think, since we were out in Las Vegas, she's been fantastic. I mean, she was really good against River Falls, and last weekend in our conference tournament and Friday, Saturday, I think she averaged 22 points and 15 rebounds over those two games. So, you know, it's. I think they want to speed the game up. We're not against playing fast. It's just a matter of handling their pressure and, you know, getting the shots we want to get. And we've been pretty good defensively all year against everybody we've seen, so hopefully we can do that again tomorrow night. But, they're a good program and a good basketball team, and you know, we expect it to be a heck of a game, just like any game at this point in the season in the tournament. There are no easy ones, so we're looking forward to it.
I'm looking at the stats, and I almost feel like Diana Jacklin and Kaylee Kakorian are twins. 13.9 points for Jacklin, 13.4 for Corcoran, 9 rebounds for Jacklin, 5.7 for Corcoran. Jacklin shoots 56%, Kakorian shoots 52%. The two of them have both taken 2 3-pointers and missed both of them. they both shoot a little over 60% from the free throw line. The only difference is Diana Jacklin kind of likes to block shots, 72 on the season so far, though she's handed out 61 assists and gotten 42 steals. You know, that's nothing to take away from Danny Ripke and Allison Grossel and the rest of the squad, but certainly those two certainly make their presence known.
Right. I mean, that's where the majority of our offense comes, and we're third in the country in field goal percentage because we get good shots from those two guys or those two girls, and you know, they're their numbers are very similar, but they play a different style.
Yes.
You know, Kaylee's a bigger, stronger kid, and Diana's, you know, very athletic and can do a lot of different things. And, you know, we ask a lot of Diana, and she's taking that on. She's a, she defends the other team's best player in the post. And like you said, she's a really good shot blocker. I think she had 6 or 7 in that game against River Falls in December. And, you know, Kaylee's one of those kids that scores. I mean, there's kids that, you know, they find the ball and they, you know, they're hunting the ball a lot. I kind of wish she'd do screen a little more sometimes, but somebody's got to score, and she's very capable that way. And, you know, drawing the attention to those two, you know, kind of frees us up on the outside. And, you know, the game we beat Wheaton last week, last Friday in the conference tournament, Ripke was 6 out of 9 from 3. So, you know, we kind of try to make our, you know, take what's available to us. And, you know, we've got an inside game, we've got outside game, and as long as we take care of the basketball appropriately, I like our chances with, you know, with any of those people shooting the ball. So, you know, but you're right. It's primarily Jacqueline and Corcoran that people focus on, and then we, you know, we kind of go from there.
Third ever NCAA appearance for Carthage, all been under your watch, I believe, if I remember correctly. Last time made it to the Sweet 16. Obviously, you have Whitewater ahead of you, and then possibly DePauw. Most likely, though, Westminster could always pull the upset. What needs to get done this weekend?
I think we just need to keep playing, you know, with the resolve we've been playing with the last, you know, 3 weeks or so, it'll be interesting because they're different styles. I know DePauw's not as up tempo a game as Whitewater is, but I think for us, it's more about taking care of the ball. Like I said, we're a real high percentage team offensively. As long as we get the ball in the places we want to get it to and get good shots, we're very efficient. And then I like us defensively and on the boards. And I think we're pretty tough that way. And, you know, it's just a matter of kind of, you know, and the funny thing is we've gone through the games that we struggled in. It seems to be that you need other people to step up. Like, we had some shots made by some of the kids off the bench, Christy Schmidt and Haley Stursick, and that, you know, and those games that kind of were back and forth in our conference were decided not necessarily by the star players, although they, you know, kind of carried their weight and did their normal stuff or even a little more. It's getting a kid to step up that the other team's not expecting and makes a shot or gets a defensive stop or gets a rebound that separates those games at this level, because all the teams are good and there's gonna likely come down to a couple possessions here and there, and who wins those extra possessions, you know, it tends to have an advantage in close games. So we're hoping to be that team for this weekend and maybe a little bit longer.
You're the chair of the Central Region of the Division III regional women's side, so obviously you're on the national chair. Interesting that Central got at-large bids from River Falls, Whitewater, WashU, Eau Claire, and obviously Carthage. And certainly I know that when it comes to your team, you're technically out of the mix. And Robin Hamilton talked about how, you know, conference affiliations and regional selections aren't necessarily, you know, kept track of. But that's certainly quite a collection of teams that came out of the Central this year. Your take on that from your point of view?
You know, my bias would tell you it's a really, really good region. If you look back in history and look at the teams that have won national championships, a lot of them have come from the group
Sure.
that you mentioned or the leagues that you mentioned. So, you know, we've got, you know, Milliken from our league has won a national championship. You know, obviously WashU and, you know, some of the Wisconsin State schools have won championships. So it's their teams that with, and this year, and it seemed that, especially in the Wisconsin State League, that they had 4 teams that stood out and won 20-plus games, and all of our teams in our region that you mentioned are high strength of schedule teams. So when you look at those numbers, they won a lot of games. They're high strength of schedules. They tend to compete against each other, so there's a lot of commonality there where you can look at things. But it's a tough region, and you know, it just kind of turned out that way that we were, you know, we had a lot of teams represent us, and it, you know, it's the other thing that I think you have to remember is the UAA is one of the few leagues, I think the Southern League too has the same thing, is that they're spread out over different regions, yeah. And we just so happen in this go round, and you know, we have Wash U and Chicago, so those two eat up spots in our region that are, you know, they're not necessarily going to come up in other regions. Chicago, you know, because that league is spread nationally, but we're also represented by, you know, or we have to have them represented in the central region. You're going to see, you know, it looks like we have more teams in than you might actually have.
Certainly, yeah, certainly a strong year though in the central. A lot of really good teams in there this year, and certainly it's going to be fun to watch down that road. I think, yeah, we're not saying it's bad by any manner of the fact.
No,
it's just very interesting.
That's not. Yeah. I wasn't trying to say that.
No, I know.
when you come across with, you know, the you know, and I think the first blush is, well, how can one league get four teams in and that kind of thing for Wisconsin State League? And yeah, I mean the NESCAC has usually three or four, and the UAA usually has three or four, so it's not unusual for the, but it is sometimes tough to, you know, sometimes there's a perfect storm of one or two other teams might have struggled that year in different regions that are normally good teams, and it opens the door for that to happen. But it is more of an anomaly to have that many from one league than it is. But our region, I think, is going to be pretty well represented most of the time.
Absolutely. Well, hey, thank you. I appreciate you taking the time to join us tonight. I know you've got a little bit more work ahead of you, and obviously the game tomorrow against Whitewater. Of course, those games being played at DePaul in Greencastle, Indiana, as you mentioned. As always, we give the coach the final word here on Hoopsville. Any final thoughts you'd like to share with those who are listening?
No, you know, this is a fun time of year. It's good to see these teams getting together and getting out there, and we're down to the 64, and you guys do a fantastic job promoting it, from being involved with that tournament in Las Vegas to, you know, and obviously we're giving you credit for having five teams, so you guys might be like the Central Region. You're overloading the bracket with teams, but it's fun to, you know, fun to be playing right now, and the women's basketball Division III just keeps getting better, and it's so hard to just get into the tournament. We're, you know, we're honored to be out there playing, and we're looking forward to 3 weeks. And you know, being on those committees, you know, I'm going to Holland no matter what, and same thing. I was going to the tournament no matter what. It's just nice to have my team along with me for this weekend, and you know, we'll see what we can do. We'll keep playing till they tap us out. So we're gonna.
Very good, Coach. Well, good luck the rest of the way. Obviously, some of our gang will see you in Holland. In the meantime, good luck this weekend, and we'll talk soon.
Okay, thanks a lot. We'll have to have a beer or something in Holland.
There we go. Take care, Coach.
Take care. Thank you.
Tim Bernero will joining us here on the Hoopsville Hotline. Pat Coleman will join him in Holland. I'll have to get that beer from afar in Salem, Virginia, but I like the idea nonetheless. We're going to take a very quick break on the other side. Southern Maine's women's basketball coach, Gary Fifield, will join us. You're listening to Hoopsville, presented by D3Hoops.com. We'll be back after this.
Dance floor, do you confuse state capitals and read too many celebrity gossip magazines? Well, if you answered yes, you may have what it takes to adopt a teen from foster care, because teens don't need perfection, they need you. So if you think an MP3 is a computer virus, it's okay. There are thousands of teens in foster care who would love to put up with you. For more information, call 1-888-200-4005 or go to AdoptUsKids.org. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, Adopt Us Kids, and the Ad Council.
All season long, let D3Football.com be your home for all the Division III football action on the road to the Stag Bowl. From interactive blogs and message boards to columns from around the region and around the nation on your favorite teams, nobody covers NCAA Division III better than D3Football.com. As the playoffs approach, get the scoop on who's in and who's out from the experts who picked all 32 teams last year. Don't go anywhere else. Get the info from the source for Division III football at www.d3football.com.
NCAA Women's College Basketball. All day, every day, our game. These women can really play. Filling it up, knocking them down, and bringing it home. It's basketball at its purest. For family fun and great entertainment, there's nothing like it. All day, every day, our game. NCAA Women's College Basketball.
Who are you?
Who can make you cheer?
And play your fight song?
Who can bring you to your feet?
Or bring you to your knees?
When the game is on the line, who do you want to take the last shot?
NCAA basketball. Who's your team?
And welcome back to Hoopsville. I'm your host, Dave McHugh, broadcasting out of our Hoopsville studios in the Baltimore area. If you have any questions in the last few minutes of our show, email us at Hoopsville at d3hoops.com. That's Hoopsville at d3hoops.com. Your AOLIM is Hoopsville2000. You can also join us on Twitter at d3hoopsville or hashtag Hoopsville. You can also join us on Facebook at facebook.com/Hoopsville. I think I got a lot of this covered. There's also a chat room alongside if you happen to be listening to us on our actual Ustream page versus the d3hoopsville.com page. Think I've got that all covered. Going to go right back to our Hoopsville hotline and joining us on the show for the first time in several years, Southern Maine women's basketball coach Gary Fifield. Coach, welcome back to Hoopsville.
Thank you very much, Dave.
I certainly appreciate you taking the time to join us here. Welcome back to the NCAA tournament, or I shouldn't say welcome back, but welcome to the NCAA tournament. You'll be taking on Bowdoin on tomorrow evening at Ithaca at 6 o'clock, of course you lost to Rhode Island College in the LEC championship game earlier on, but otherwise a pretty solid year this year. 21-6, 11-3 in the conference. What's your take on the season?
I'm real happy with how our season has gone. You know, if you told us at the start of the year that we'd had wins over Babson, Bowdoin, Kobe, Rhode Island, you know, we ended up playing 10 regionally ranked opponents and going 6-4 against them. So, I felt that the strength of our schedule was certainly very good. I think our SOS at the end was 20th in the country. And, I'm excited with getting back to the tournament. We had a one-year hiccup there last year, but certainly excited to be back.
Of course, we should make a point that you actually retired for 1 year and then came back to the coaching ranks. I've got to ask, since we haven't chatted with you about that, was the year that hard that you just couldn't resist coming back?
No, it was a combination of things. Some of it was my assistant, who was the interim head coach. He went back to his former college, and we had gone through the search, and really, we were either going to have to reopen the search completely, or I could get back into coaching. And I mean, I missed it. You know, I think sometimes you have to step away to realize what you have. But at the same time, the year off was very good. You know, this is basketball is a long season. It's very tiring, and, you need some time to re-energize at times.
I'm talking to Coach Gary Fifield here from Southern Maine, and we should point out Southern Maine has been synonymous with good basketball on the women's side and certainly has had some incredible teams. You're making your 25th appearance in 27 years as a member of the NCAA. It almost becomes a given that Southern Maine will be penciled into the bracket in some way, shape, or form. And obviously, you've had another great year. Is this something that the campus still rallies behind? Are they just as excited as I remember them back in the 90s and early 2000s and all that heyday?
Yeah, we still have a very loyal following of fans that, have adopted our program and follow us throughout. We have some people who might even beat us to some of the away sites. So, it's our success has certainly led to us having some very loyal fans.
Let's talk about your team just a little bit. And shamelessly, I love the fact that I don't know if you remember the story or not, but when I was a young lad, my parents moved me from downtown Chicago to down east Maine to a town named Woodland. And now twice I'm talking about one of your top players on your team being from Woodland High School. This one's Courtney Cochran, following in the wings of Ashley Marble and others, even from Callis High School up there. You seem to have tapped into down east Maine to get some really good talent.
Certainly, we've been very fortunate to get some talent from that down east area, that's for sure. When you're talking about Woodland and Callis, you're talking about very small communities where,
yes.
when they go to the state tournament, they put a sign up, last one out of town, turn the lights off.
You'd pretty much be dead on with that, yes. But, I mean, tell us a little bit about Courtney and the strength she brings along with other, other players. You had five players on the all-conference team this year in Courtney and Haley Jordan and Nicole Garland and Kim Rivett and Renee Nicholas.
Yeah, and the interesting thing is Kim and Renee are both from the same high school, and they both made the all-defensive team. And the interesting thing is that Kim making that team comes off the bench.
Yeah.
She's just a spark plug defensively and a real game changer.
Talking to Coach Gary Fifield again, dancing in the NCAA tournament. Coach, you have went over the 600 win mark this year. Certainly just seem to keep adding on to the win total. What's it been like in your career, and what was it like to win number 600?
Well, in terms of 600, I guess it's just another number that you're going to get at some point. If you've been coaching as long as I have, I've been here at 24 years, so you're going to get there. But, I just think I look back to all the good players that we've had in the program, all the assistants that have been a part of the program. The 600 wins has my name on it, but it certainly is hundreds of people who have contributed to that over the years.
You will take on Bowdoin in the first round in a rarity. The game's at Ithaca, but in a rarity, you actually played Bowdoin earlier this season, beating them 63-49. Obviously, that was back at the end of January, or end of November, I should say. What do you take from that game? What do you take from video you've seen of them now? How are you scouting for this game?
Well, we're very familiar with Bowdoin over the years. As you know, we play them every year in regular season as well as we've seen them a number of times in the NCAA tournament. We're both very different teams from back, Tuesday after Thanksgiving, that's for sure. But they've seen us, we've seen them, so I don't think there'll be too many surprises.
Obviously, you've got them, and of course, you're traveling to Ithaca for both main teams. That's a bit of a haul. How have you prepared the team for that travel?
Well, we went halfway yesterday or last night because they're getting a major storm in the Northeast, so we kind of lucked out and got out of there just before it started, and then we finished the trip today and. Right now, we're just pulling back into our hotel from our practice this evening.
Well, very good, Coach. I appreciate you joining us on the show here. Thank you for taking the time. Obviously, Bowdoin ahead of you here, and then possibly Ithaca and or Southern Elms, should you be able to win. Certainly looking forward to seeing how the Huskies play. But as always, we give the coach the final word here on Hoopsville. Any final thoughts you want to share with those who are listening?
Thank you for having us on. And we're looking forward to a good game tomorrow night with Bowdoin. And, sometimes you wonder, if this game was being played back in Maine, I think we'd might be able to draw a couple thousand people or more to that game. But, you know, we both had to travel out here about 8 hours to, to play.
Yeah. And there's no straight line there either.
No, there's not. No, there's not.
No, not at all. Well, Coach, thank you so much. I appreciate it, and we'll talk to you soon.
Okay, thanks for having me on.
No problem. Thank you. Coach Gary Fifield joining us from Southern Maine. The Huskies again playing Bowdoin, as he alluded to. I think that's one of the rare games of teams that have already faced each other earlier in the season. And I think he's got a point. Two Maine teams having to travel all the way to upstate New York to play that game. That might be one of the small flaws in the women's bracket. I don't think it's a big deal, certainly, but it's maybe a little disappointing to those Maine fans of good teams like Bowdoin and Southern Maine that they're going to either have to travel a very long distance to see their teams in action or just be able to watch it on video. But nonetheless, appreciate him taking the time to join us, and we thank him and wish them good luck. And we'll go right back to the Hoopsville Hotline, and Pat Coleman joining us there as we'll break down the women's bracket here quickly as we are in overtime on Hoopsville. And I have a flight to catch tomorrow, so we won't waste too much time on this. And Chris, well, he's got to get his beauty sleep. I'll admit, I think I missed that initially, Pat. One little snag there on the women's side. I know they talked to Robin, was very thrilled about making sure a lot of the matchups in the first round didn't have regional or conference or previous game affiliations, and this one kind of flies smack in the middle of that one.
Well, yeah, and you know, when I was putting together my mock bracket, for example, on the women's side, it was very difficult with all the main teams, especially all the main teams I had in the field, for example, Colby, to keep them, put them at separate places, make sure they hadn't played each other. You know,
you and I went over that for a while. We kept staring at that one section, and just I think we made one change, and I don't even know if that was really a great solution.
So, yeah, I wish we'd had the software that they have at the NCAA for that. But, you know, to be honest with you, a rematch of a regular season non-conference game
is not the end of the world. No.
And it's certainly not prohibited.
No.
They happen. I think there's actually, there might be one on the men's side, too. But
I think you're right.
It's such not a big deal.
Yeah,
that I didn't really, maybe Worcester's played Maryville this year or something like that.
I think you're right, yeah. Yeah.
There's something along those
But I would
lines.
Just say, you know, that one could have maybe been switched with Elms. I don't think, you know, Ithaca, it's just a thought. But you're right. It's really not that big a deal.
Well, to be honest with you, I don't know. Ithaca being a top team deserves to play somebody better than, or not as good as those two.
You're right.
Yeah. Have a better matchup, let's put it that way.
And yet again, another player on a Southern Maine squad coming out of my neck of the woods. This is getting a little to the point of eerie.
And that's literal, right? Woods, Nick?
Yeah, literal is right. She's from Waite, Maine, which is even more rural than my town, and my town's about 1,500 in the summer.
Yeah.
Yeah, you guys figure that out. And I moved there from downtown Chicago. The joke is, by the way, Pat, the population of the block I lived on in Chicago was more than the population of the town I moved to.
I was just in downtown Chicago not too long ago.
Well, you should have dropped by the old house and said hi. Not that you would have had any clue where to find it.
Right.
Let's work on the women's bracket. We did this with the men, obviously, because on Monday, the men were playing a couple games tonight. The women are not, and so we'll break this down. We'll do it quickly. We're just talking about who's going to get out of the weekend, essentially. We'll start in the upper left, and Amherst, quick thought. I said it earlier. Don't know if you heard me, that I have heard some feedback regarding the fact that the men and women are hosting here for Saturday with that extra team in town, getting that practice done. A little bit more complicated than maybe many thought it could be, and as a result, I wouldn't be surprised if they revisit this in the future. But nonetheless, Amherst hosting, they're taking on St. Joseph's of Brooklyn and Babson and Bridgewater State sitting in there. Who do you think comes out of the weekend?
Well, I mean, that Amherst-St. Joe's game is the 164 game, I'll be honest with you.
Yeah.
St. Joe's is 13-13, so hopefully I don't think anybody thinks is going to be too insulted when they realize that they are the bottom seed in the tournament and they're faced off against the top team in Division III women's basketball. On the other side, Babson gets a chance to, again, play away from home. They haven't been blessed with a home game in the NCAA tournament during any of their recent tournament runs, and maybe they'll continue to try to boost the strength of schedule. Hey, you know, to be honest with you, if they beat Amherst on Saturday, then you know, it doesn't really matter where they played, but I would be kind of surprised if that happens. Amherst is very much on a roll, obviously.
Yeah, Amherst playing very good basketball. I'd be surprised if they don't come out of that. I actually would be very surprised if they don't make it to the Final Four. Juniata, landmark runner-up, is playing host to Castleton State, St. Vincent and York in there as well. And your take on that, Castleton State, our school of the week, and St. Vincent traveling to Juniata again, and York Spartans with two teams in the tournament, the women certainly playing well as well.
Yeah, and you know, I've never really had much of a feel for what Juniata is all about, you know. But the thing is, of course, that Juniata won at St. Vincent earlier this season.
Yep.
I think Juniata and St. Vincent should probably both win their opening round games, although I would not exclude York, at least not automatically.
You just don't know. Her squad sometimes just comes out ready to play.
Yeah, and you know, they've played, York has played a bunch of good teams, obviously, this year. You know, they're 22-5, but three of those losses are to Mary Washington, and nobody's beaten Mary Washington, so they're 22-2 against everybody else. But I think the thing is that regardless of who wins the St. Vincent-York game, I think Juniata advances out of that pod.
Yeah, I've seen Juniata play in person a couple times, and I can't get a read on them either. I haven't been overly impressed, but they keep winning. And when you keep winning at this point, you know, midway through the season, I'm not impressed. But three quarters of the way through the season, I'm thinking, wait a minute, what is going on? When you're at this point in the season and you've had one loss and it came in the end of the season, you know, I can't knock them too hard. I should say two losses. My bad. I can't knock them. Don't they have two losses?
They lost to Catholic.
Yeah. I'm sorry. I thought they had two losses. So you think Juniata comes out of there, and obviously we'll take on Amherst. Rhode Island College is hosting Baruch, and Hartwick and Emmanuel are playing there as well. This certainly is ripe for the taking for Rhode Island College, but maybe not as easy as it looks.
Well, I don't know if I necessarily agree. Here's the thing I think, Dave, is that Rhode Island College has been so under the radar this season. They have been, they ran off this string of 6, 9, 12, 15, 17 consecutive wins over the course of a couple months before they lost at Southern Maine a few weeks ago. Then they came back, beat Southern Maine in the conference championship game 14 days later. I think Southern Maine has got this pretty much all right in front of them. I think that, they've got home court advantage, which helps.
Wait, who did you say?
They've got home court advantage.
Who?
Rhode Island College.
I thought you said Southern Maine.
Oh no, I flipped through Southern Maine for a second when I was talking about RIC's winning streak at the end of it.
I got worried there for a second.
Since then, I think they righted the ship a little bit, and it was just one 4-point loss in Maine. I don't think there are a lot of places in Maine as a Division III basketball team that you could go and lose by 4 points and be a pretty darn good basketball team. So RIC at 24-3. I think ends up 26-3 by the end of the weekend. You know, after that, obviously, kind of uncharted territory for them. But I think that this is, they had never even played in the LEC championship game until last week. So this is a little bit new for them. But I think that they should be good enough to get out of this weekend.
Yeah, should be. I think for me, it's just a matter of I think Hartwick's a wild card. I just don't know how to take my take on them, and so that's why I say.
Yeah, me either. I think the thing with RAC, I really wish RAC was in our top 25, to be honest with you. They are their fifth out among others receiving votes, so I think they've just played too well, and, you know, obviously Little East men is a little more prominent than Little East women's basketball these days. It used to be the other way around.
Absolutely.
and now, but I think that LEC women's basketball is good enough that their champion, especially at 24-3, ought to be in the top 25.
I want to thank Jim Wagner. Wags, I am apparently an FOW of his. A friend of Wags, it's called. He just tweeted it.
Okay.
William Patterson, Salve Regina will play at Kings, and Kings is hosting Oneonta State. This is obviously William Patterson being the top seed, but because the Pioneers men's basketball team is also hosting, the women had to travel to Kings in the middle of Pennsylvania up in the Wilkes-Barre area. I don't see. I think it'll probably be William Patterson versus Kings, and that's an interesting matchup. But I've got William Patterson coming out.
Yeah, I think so too. I mean, to be honest with you, we talked about this. Kings has played just one team that was regionally ranked all season. That was Rutgers-Newark. They lost to Rutgers-Newark you know, William Patterson in that league, et cetera, et cetera. But, you know, at the top of that league, and Rutgers Newark was, you know, I guess at best third place behind them and Kane. So I think that this is William Patterson's to win. Yeah, it's on the road. It's kind of a it's kind of an interesting place to play.
Yes.
Kings have certainly had some good teams in the past.
Mm-hmm.
That, I don't think they quite measure up this year. Although, I mean, to be honest with you, the 21-5 regional record that they put up, and you know, I didn't print out the copy of the bracket after I put the records on it. So,
right.
22-5 overall. Obviously, that's a great year for them, no doubt. And you know, some of the losses are pretty good ones. You know, they lost to Illinois Wesleyan, although it was on a neutral floor by 20 points. I mean, they've at least seen what an NCAA tournament team looks like. But William Patterson has seen that for, several times a year for a few years running now.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's jump down into the other corner, and Mary Washington is at home facing Keuka, Messiah, and Kane. The other NJAC.
That's another one of those that's a rematch, by the way, Messiah and Kane.
Yeah, Messiah and Kane, that's right. And that is a game being hosted at Mary Washington, Kane, the other NJAC team here. I think you got another great matchup with Mary Washington and Kane here. Because I think those two teams win the first round. Personally, I think the Eagles come out of this.
Yeah, I think so, too. Mary Washington, you know, I mean, I think there's a reason why they're undefeated and only ranked number 7 in our poll, and that's because, you know, they just haven't played a whole ton of, you know, challenging games. If you look at their non-conference schedule, to be honest with you, I mean, Mary Washington just didn't really play any of the top teams. There were certainly some teams they had the opportunity to, or at least, you know, geographically they're in the area of, but, you know, you play Washington and Lee, you play Roanoke, Randolph-Macon, Shenandoah, Christopher Newport. So Christopher Newport is one, and they were fairly decent this year. But, you know, you play three of your games against the ODAC, and that's, you know, not a great schedule in women's basketball anyway. Shenandoah's struggled a little bit for some time now. So I'm not sure they're necessarily so playoff tested, but it's not going to be a problem on Friday. And then on Saturday, you know, Kane could be interesting for them. You know,
mm-hmm.
still kind of interesting to kind of ponder what Kane is made of. It's been such
a season
of adversity for them.
Yeah.
You know, obviously, coach getting fired in the middle of the season, all the stuff in the preseason with the, you know, the allegations hanging over their heads, and you know, I don't know if I'm sure they probably thought at some point
it would end.
that they were going to be. Thrown under the bus, thrown to the wolves.
Yeah, that
you know
too.
I mean?
And there's scuttlebutt.
So many of the fall sports, the school had declared so many of the fall sports ineligible for the conference playoffs, and therefore the NCAA tournament.
Yeah.
That it seemed like, you know, I always kind of thought that women's basketball would be next, but you know, here
so
they are. You know, they've so if you look at going back to December 7th, where they really stunk it up, from what I understand, the 85-78 loss at DeSales, but since then. They lost to Amherst.
No surprise.
Yeah, they split two games with TCNJ, lost one in February, lost to William Patterson. You know, obviously William Patterson is pretty good. They've won everything else, including a 20-point win against Messiah. I think that you know, they could be in a position to beat Messiah again. Obviously, we're spending a lot of time in this game, but I mean Messiah is playing better. You know, they had the Division I transfer who was hurt at the beginning of the season. I'm not sure she even played. And certainly wasn't up to speed in the first meeting.
No, I don't think so.
With Kane, so that could be a different game. But I think that either one of the teams that comes out of that game is going to give Mary Washington a bit of a run. But I think Mary Washington still survives this weekend. All right. Bless you.
Yeah. Wow. You heard that? Oh, that's because Chris's mic is open. Darn it.
Sorry.
That's all right.
On the phone.
I killed my mic. Darn it.
Ah. Sorry.
Let's move down to the next one. Lebanon Valley hosting. They're taking on Vassar, Mount St. Mary's, and Gwynedd Mercy on the other side of that one. I really don't see any argument why Lebanon Valley maybe doesn't come out of this.
Yeah, I think Lebanon Valley should advance too. And probably Mount St. Mary would be the team that they would play on Saturday.
Yeah, probably.
I think, Mount St. Mary's got some, you know, some pretty good NCAA tournament experience. They're in the tournament year after year. Gwynedd Mercy's been out of it for a few years. And, you know, neither of them is in a particularly strong conference in Division III women's basketball. But I like... you know, Mount St. Mary's, you know, recent playoff experience giving them a little bit of an edge in a neutral floor game there.
Yeah. Down to the next one, Ithaca hosting. They're taking on Elms, as we mentioned earlier with the coach, Fifield, Southern Maine, and Bowdoin will be taking to the court there as well. This one's interesting. I'm not sure who I've got out of Southern Maine and Bowdoin. Southern Maine only because maybe they beat them earlier this season and have certainly been playing well. Then they're up against an Ithaca squad. I think it's one of the main schools that come out of here.
You might be right. I mean, especially if this were, you know, if this were 2007, we'd only be debating which of these two main teams coming out. And I think you're probably right this time too. I look at, you know, maybe strength of conference and the fact that they've played, you know, strong teams, you know, kind of week in and week out, that one of those teams would probably be favored against against Ithaca. But, you know, obviously that's a long way to go. The good news is that, you know, whichever team wins gets to play them on the second night, so they get a chance to see them. They get their, you know, an extra day to kind of shake off the dust of the road from their feet. You know what I mean?
Yes.
And it's not like Ithaca hasn't played anybody all year. Obviously, they played Rochester. They played at Hope. You know, they played Cornell, and that's the Division I one. So,
yeah.
You know, they've played some pretty good opponents. Obviously, so you know, I wouldn't just automatically write off Ithaca. That's for sure. And if you made me pick somebody,
yes,
I'd probably pick Ithaca, because at least I know Ithaca is going to be playing on Saturday, and I couldn't tell you which of the main teams is going to be playing on Saturday.
Fair point. Then down the lower corner, George Fox hosting over in the Northwest against Cal Luther and Lewis and Clark in Concordia, Texas on the other side. I see this as a conference rematch between George Fox and Lewis and Clark, and I just don't see any reason George Fox isn't walking out of this.
Well, you know what's interesting, and I agree with you on that last part for sure. I think this is George Fox advancing to the Sweet 16. The thing is, I don't know quite what to make of Lewis and Clark. You know, Lewis and Clark has gotten its doors blown off by George Fox late in the game the last couple times they've met.
And Concordia, you know, Texas just beat Louisiana College, so.
Yeah, I mean, who knows? Concordia, Texas kind of playing with nothing to lose.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not sure who the best team is, you know, over the course of the season that Lewis and Clark actually beat. So, you know, is it Oneonta State maybe back on November 19th? Is it Kane? Those are games that are a long, long time ago.
Yeah.
But those are the reasons why, you know, Lewis and Clark is as high as they are in the top 25.
Oh, absolutely.
It's not enough to lose to somebody three times. You got to have some wins under your belt too. And those are two fairly decent wins. Obviously, one of those teams is ranked, and the other one is in the NCAA tournament, so that helps as well. But you know, I wouldn't be surprised to see Concordia, Texas win on Friday. The thing, of course, is that it's a long trip for them.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's a very short trip for Lewis and Clark. It's a familiar floor. You know, they've played there twice already this year. And, you know, the farthest that Concordia, Texas has traveled has been, I guess, to Mississippi College. Maybe University of the Ozarks.
Or Louisiana College. Oh no, they're past there.
Actually, those were home games. Come to think of it, so they didn't travel that this year at all.
It's conference championship,
Louisiana College, or Ozarks. I'm not sure which is further.
Anyway, and of course, if George Fox walks out of that, unfortunately, I can read the tea leaves. As good as they are, they are not.
It would be very difficult. Yeah,
George. They're not flying a Mary Washington. They're not flying a Lebanon Valley. They're not going to.
No. But it's not impossible. Maybe it is impossible. It's very close, though. If you came up with George Fox, either of the main teams, unfortunately, I'm not sure I can come up with a combination that makes them all 500 miles from each other. But you know, Mary Washington is as far south as this sectional goes, and
George
I think
Fox
Vassar would be with Vassar would be within 500 miles of the main schools. That's about as good as we could hope for in terms of spreading them far enough apart so that George Fox could host this sectional.
Yeah,
but the other thing is, too, if it ends up being just one extra flight, you never know. They could spring for it. They've done it. They did it in baseball last year.
It's true.
They did it in football.
But I just don't. I just don't see it right now.
Oh, I know. I know it's highly unlikely.
Yeah.
But I just don't want to. I don't ever want to come out and say anything is completely impossible after what's happened the last year or so. They've actually loosened up the purse strings just a hair.
Just a wee bit. We got half of this to go, so let's jump into the upper right. DePauw hosting Westminster of Missouri and Whitewater and Carthage on the other side of this. I think DePauw comes out of it all in all, but that Carthage team who we saw in Vegas is my wild card.
I like Carthage quite a bit, obviously. We talked about, you know, what they've done. I think that either team that comes out of the bottom half of that pot has a really good shot against DePauw. DePauw has obviously done very well this year. The conference they're in this year is not quite as strong as the SCAC was. So the good thing is that DePauw continues to play a strong non-conference schedule. So it's not like DePauw got here for no reason. I mean,
no.
They beat Illinois Wesleyan. They beat Wash U. Those are two teams that would be on anybody's list of perennial powers in Division III women's basketball. So
absolutely,
it's not like they come in completely untested. But I think either one of those teams, whether it's Whitewater or Carthage, has a good shot. And I think the Whitewater Carthage game will be particularly interesting. I think those teams are actually fairly similar. Whitewater has. Has a big kid inside who is, pretty darn good and can match up pretty well. And I don't have, of course, my sure. Whitewater roster handy. I just saw them a couple of weeks ago. I think that, they would match up pretty well, and that'd be an interesting game, a pretty good battle. And, the top 25 poll would suggest it's going to be a pretty good game, too. So I don't think I'm surprising anybody there. But I think they go, pretty close in terms of personnel, not just in close of success on the floor.
Near where I will be this weekend in Danville, Kentucky. I'll be in Lexington, Kentucky. Center will be hosting Guilford, Wash U, and Ferrum. Center
is going to drive over and pick up some pregame interviews, right?
I was actually going, it's not that far. And it's been a while since I've been to Center in the first weekend. I should just do it to reminisce. I don't see why Center is not playing at home in the second round game. I don't see why they're not playing Wash U, but there I don't know what happens. I can see Wash U losing this because Center just seems to have a knack, but Center's also had a knack of maybe not pulling off the games they need to.
Yeah, I don't know. I really put this very solidly in Wash U's corner. You just look at the teams that they've lost to this year.
Oh, yeah.
Of the five teams that they've lost to, DePauw is one loss, Chicago twice, with a grand total of zero losses combined. They lost to 18-7 Emory. They lost to 19-6 Rochester, and that's the sum total of it. That's a grand total of 14 losses among five teams that they've lost to. So, I really think Wash U is in really good shape.
Of course,
Wash U would be hosting this if the men weren't hosting.
And I would say also Wash U has a secret weapon named Coach Nancy Faye. You never count Nancy Faye's
teams out.
She's
not so secret, by the way.
I know, sarcasm.
And I shouldn't say Wash U would be hosting this bracket. Obviously, they wouldn't be because of geography.
Right. Well, Guilford wouldn't be involved, right.
They're the best. I think they're the best team in this bracket, even though they draw the bracket otherwise.
Yeah, exactly. You're right. Thomas Moore is the other host. They're taking on Louisiana College, who tripped up a little bit there, as we mentioned, in Concordia, Texas. Maryville and Illinois Wesleyan on the other side of this. This is interesting. We've seen Thomas Moore. I don't think I was as impressed as I thought I would be. Louisiana College, I don't know how to read, kind of like Birmingham Southern. Illinois Wesleyan is always good. I cannot figure out who's coming out of that. I think I picked Illinois Wesleyan, but I am not absolutely sure what I did on the bracket buster.
Well, and I should say, too, if you haven't entered the bracket challenge for women's basketball yet, you still can because the women's tournament doesn't start until Friday, so you've got some time to do that.
3 o'clock Central Time, 4 o'clock
Eastern. I think that Olivia Lett is, when she's on the floor, she's one of the best players in Division III women's basketball. For Illinois Wesleyan, that's a big weapon. I really think that if she's, if she's playing, she's healthy, and I have no reason to believe she's not healthy, and stays out of foul trouble, then they're the team to beat in this pod. I agree. Thomas Moore's played better of late. Obviously that conference isn't world beaters either, the PAC. So I'm not sure how much of it is that. When a team goes on a big run, starting in January or so, is the perennial question has to be. Is that because, they're that good, or is that because, they're running through a conference that, may not be challenging them so much? And I don't know which the answer is. I just do know that Thomas Moore is certainly playing better. And, we saw they had the pieces to be successful when we saw them in Vegas. They just
didn't put it all together there. No. Absolutely.
And we matched them up against some pretty tough teams.
It did. I think Simpson came roaring back on them, if I remember correctly.
And the other game was against River Falls. So.
Yeah, and then River Falls got tripped up by Carthage. So those were really good teams there. So who do you have coming out again?
Illinois Wesleyan would be my pick there.
The other corner of the bottom corner of the upper right, Mount Union hosting La Roche, Muhlenberg and Catholic in that one. I have Muhlenberg beating Catholic,
I suspect you're probably right.
Yeah,
there.
I've seen Muhlenberg and I've seen Catholic, and I'm going to take Muhlenberg in that one. Mount Union is playing terrific basketball. I've got them facing off on the other side. And as much as Muhlenberg's got a great player in, I'm just going to say Chili, because I just like saying the fact that a player's name is Chili. And as much as I'd like to see her score 34 points in Eclipse 2000, I just don't see Muhlenberg getting past Mount Union.
Well, I mean, she may, you know, if she's playing two games, she's obviously got a much better shot.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
At getting
she scored 28
points.
Against Hopkins.
And, you know, if the Muhlenberg team that lost 5 out of 8 in January and February makes the trip to Mount Union, then they may struggle to get out of Friday night.
They're not.
I think you're right. They do advance, and I see Mount Union winning on Saturday.
They're far healthier than that 5 out of 8 is. I know that much, but I just don't see Mount Union being able to knock. I don't see the Purple Raiders being knocked off at home. Now in the lower right, St. Thomas women hosting. They're taking on Martin Luther. Coe and River Falls, I think, is a great matchup in that little pod there. I don't know. I think I took Coe out of that, believe it or not, and I took St. Thomas, and I think I took St. Thomas out of it altogether.
You know, Dave, I feel bad that I haven't seen the St. Thomas women play, and they are...
I
know, they're just a 15, 20-minute drive from me.
Wow.
It's just that every time, every time I had a free Saturday and was able to go somewhere, they were playing, you know, somebody from the bottom half or bottom third even of the conference. It just didn't feel like I was going to learn a whole lot, seeing them against, you know, Bethel or not Bethel, like Carleton and some of the teams that are really struggling.
That can make sense.
Women's basketball. So I just didn't, you know, I don't want to see somebody good play somebody bad, because, you know, 26-1 against 3-22, you're going to end up.
You're not going to see
a game that.
Yeah.
Yeah. 68-48 or something
like
that.
You're going to see reserves. You're not going to get a chance to really see a tested team.
Yeah.
But who do you think comes out of it though?
Oh, right. A good question. I've seen River Falls play three times now, because twice in Vegas and once at River Falls a couple weeks ago. Here's the thing about River Falls that impressed me, Dave, is they were, if you remember at when we saw them in Vegas, they were they were really very heavily reliant on their starting five.
Yes.
Looks like I've actually seen them play four times this year. I forgot I saw them play Stevens Point, too. Jeez. Over the course of the season, I was really impressed with, Tess Leaders has really come on for them. I saw her, pick a ball off the glass, off a missed shot against Whitewater, and just sprint up the floor and finish with an incredible layup with in traffic. And I just thought, that was completely not the team that we saw in Las Vegas.
Hmm.
I think they're playing better than they were then. I'm not sure that's necessarily good enough, because I think, Coe obviously has been on enough of a roll to get into the NCAA tournament to win that conference championship. St. Thomas has only won, 26 games in a row. I think that's going to be a really good game, River Falls and St. Thomas. I find it hard to – I don't want to rely on the fact that I've seen River Falls play and have that count against St. Thomas.
Sure.
So I guess I'd probably go chalk and go St. Thomas, but, that may be my least confident pod pick so far.
Right below them, it's Tufts against Misericordia, Tufts at home, and Johns Hopkins versus University of New England. I have a University of New England on this one. Johns Hopkins is a good squad. I just don't see them matching up well against New England. And I've got Tufts over Misericordia, as much as I love our good friend Dave Martin. Tufts is tough, and I've got Tufts as a result coming out of this against New England.
You know, what's cool is that Tufts is actually getting to host NCAA tournament events for the first time. If you remember, they had this floor.
this
gymnasium that wasn't 94 feet.
Yes,
and
I do.
It's this amazing, awesome old gymnasium. But you know, it was built in a different era, obviously.
Yeah.
It just wasn't NCAA regulation length. So they completely remodeled it. You know, they rotated the floor by 90 degrees so you could play it across or you know lengthwise instead of widthwise. So this is going to be pretty cool for them to be able to play at home. You know, I like that obviously the University of New England has gone out and, you know, despite the fact that they're not in a very strong conference, they've gone out and scheduled some of the really strong teams in New England in Division III. So I don't think they'll be intimidated.
No,
I don't think they'll have any problem adjusting to the speed of the NCAA tournament. I just think Tufts at home has enough of an edge to get through there.
And then down one more slot, Calvin hosting Wisconsin Lutheran and Stevens Point and Franklin on the other side. I'm taking out another Wisconsin team with Franklin winning and facing off against Calvin. And that is a great matchup, and I just, for default reasons, gave it to Calvin.
You know, I think I would have Stevens Point winning on Friday night, but despite that, I'm not sure I have them going much, going any farther than that. Calvin is... you know, Calvin's obviously a very strong team this year.
Yes.
You know, the only thing I dislike is the fact that they're on the same side of the same bracket as the University of Chicago. Otherwise, I think they would go a little bit further.
And then in the very bottom corner, Chicago hosting Monmouth and Simpson-Eau Claire on the other matchup. I took Simpson just because I like Simpson. It's nothing against Eau Claire. I took out another Wisconsin team. I guess I was just in the mood. Because mainly it didn't matter. Chicago was coming out of this anyway.
Yeah, I think so, too. I agree. Chicago shouldn't have any trouble with Monmouth on Friday. And I think that'll help, too. They'll probably have their starters a little bit more rested. I think the one thing that's interesting is that, you know, of the three other than Monmouth, none of these conferences plays back-to-back games.
Yeah, true.
And including the UAA. So, obviously, Chicago is accustomed to playing twice within
36-ish
you know, 42 hours or
yeah,
so with
like
some travel in between oftentimes.
Yeah.
And that's certainly a little bit different. You know, Eau Claire, the WIAC doesn't play back-to-back games. Iowa Conference doesn't play back-to-back games. So everybody's going to be in a little bit of a, you know, a different situation. And I think the thing is that whichever one wins that game, I suspect Eau Claire, they're going to have to, you know, prepare on a very quick turnaround for
yep.
the number two team in the country.
Yeah.
The one thing I'll say is that I think Eau Claire probably has the best individual player in that pod in Ellen Plendel, the 6'5", I believe, senior center.
I think you're right.
So she's, you know, she's somebody that Chicago would obviously need to have a pretty good game plan for, but I think that Chicago has enough overall talent to come out of it.
And the reason I took Simpson over Eau Claire, too, though, it was more than just an educated guess. I mean, I saw what they did against River Falls in Las Vegas. I've seen what they've done, and I just I think that causes some matchup problems. You're right, Eau Claire's got the advantage inside, but I think Simpson's got some speed, and that's why I picked him. But then, like I said, Chicago, I think, is walking out of here rather easily, so...
I agree. I think no matter what happens on Friday night, Chicago's the one that continues.
Yeah. So there you go. There's Pat and I's take on the women's first weekend, and obviously we'll get a lot more ideas on the rest as we tackle Hoopsville on Sunday night. Again, you'll
and
be at...
be good because we'll know who the sectional hosts are by then as
will
well.
Will we? Sometimes I've heard
well,
of wait till Monday.
To.
Yeah, I don't know.
We're supposed to get them on it. You know, that's the one. They have not, of all the things, and I was reading back through some of my previous NCAA tournament previews, as I was writing the one for this week, of all the things that they've screwed up over the past decade or so, they haven't messed this up yet.
No.
They've always had sectional hosts by at least 2 p.m. Eastern time
that's
on
true.
Sunday.
That's true. I did forget about that. So they usually, and that's because they're obviously planning ahead and kind of have a good idea of what's going on. So hopefully, and again, reminder, while the men have got the rights to host this weekend in an even year, that means the women will get the rights to host next weekend, which means all you Amherst fans, I promise you, the men will be on the road should they win. And William Patterson fans, should the men win, they will be on the road next weekend.
Unless William Patterson women lose.
That's what I'm trying to allude to, yes. If everybody holds serve, as it were, William Patterson not necessarily holding serve on the road, but they are the top, the topper seed, as it were. So just keep that in mind for everybody out there who may be paying attention. I think that'll do it, Rap. We went pretty much into triple overtime here, but we'll wrap it up. Any final thoughts before the weekend? Obviously, you'll be at River Falls for those games.
Well, Dave, all I can say is if you're involved in the broadcast, no wonder it went to triple overtime.
Yeah, yeah, very good call. Yeah.
Looking forward to it. I think.
Yeah, I saw you, by the way, reference that game recently in something. I don't know what it was, but thank you.
Yeah, well, it was we wrote a Around the Nation about Virginia Wesleyan, so we talked a little bit about Tantan Belenga and the championship run that they put together in 2007, and I believe did that. Actually, that didn't involve one of the triple overtime games, come to think of it. That was a different Virginia Wesleyan year.
The Tantan Belenga was when you and I were at the game, and I was 5 feet from him when he hit the three to win the Elite Eight game or the Sweet 16.
Yeah, and why didn't you have a hand in his face?
I you know what? I figured that that should have been the defender's responsibility, even though he was about 20 feet away.
Fair enough.
It was when they collapsed on Brandon Adair, and no one realized Brandon had figured out how to find his teammates on the outside.
Yeah, that worked out fairly well for them.
Yeah, just a little bit. Oh, thanks, Pat. I appreciate it. And have safe travels to River Falls for the weekend, and we'll talk to you probably on Sunday as well.
Sounds good, man.
All right, take care. Pat Coleman joining us here on the Hoopsville Hotline. We're going to quickly wrap this show up. Chris needs to get his beauty sleep. I need to get ready to get on the road early tomorrow morning and fly out to Lexington. Not actually to Lexington, but I will be at Transylvania. Pat Coleman again at River Falls. Frank Rossi will wrap up his NYU work and then head to William-Patterson tomorrow. We're all producing and helping the broadcast in those three locations. By the way, our good friend Gordon Mann, he'll be at Cabrini for their broadcast. And again, all the links, all video, live stats, and all that that we know of and gathering that information throughout the night will be posted on d3hoops.com under our scores or in our tournament page. You can get everything you need to know, including the videos and all that stuff there. I only think there's a handful of teams that do not have video. Actually, Pat says they're now all up. I believe Kings, we know on the women's side, doesn't appear to have any video, which is a shame. It looks like they are the only one. So congratulations not only to all the other schools out there who are able to provide video. We certainly applaud that at D3Hoops.com and D3Sports.com. It gives everybody a chance to see the games. But nonetheless, you will have plenty to do. And if you have an evening to enjoy it, sit back, pull up a couple games at the same time if your computer allows it, and enjoy Division III basketball. This is definitely the fun part of the season as we march our way to Salem, Virginia for the men and Holland, Michigan for the women. Thanks for listening to Hoopsville tonight, and we'll look forward to seeing you back here on Sunday evening as we wrap up the first weekend of the Division III men's and women's basketball championship tournaments. Good night, everybody.